Good evening, London. Allow me first to apologize for this
emergency channel.
I do, like many of you, appreciate the comforts of the everyday routine, the security of the familiar, the tranquility, repetition.
Bloody hell.
I enjoy them as much as any bloke. But in the spirit of commemoration, whereby those important events of the past, usually associated with someone's death or the end of some awful bloody struggle, are celebrated with a nice holiday, I thought we could mark this November the 5th, a day that is sadly no longer remembered, by taking some time out of our daily lives to sit down and have a little chat. There are, of course, those who do not want us to speak.
Let me think, just let me think.
I suspect even now, orders are being shouted into telephones and men with guns will soon be on their way.
It's Chancellor Sutler.
Damn it!
Why? Because while the truncheon may be used in lieu of conversation, words will always retain their power. Words offer the means to meaning, and for those who will listen, the enunciation of truth. And the truth is, there is something terribly wrong with this country, isn't there?
You designed it, sir. You wanted it foolproof. You told me every television in London.
Cruelty and injustice, intolerance and oppression. And where once you had the freedom to object, to think and speak as you saw fit, you now have sensors and systems of surveillance coercing your conformity and subverting your submission.
We need cameras.
How did this happen? Who's to blame? Well, certainly there are those who are more responsible than others, and they will be held accountable. But again, truth be told, if you're looking for the guilty, you need only look into a mirror.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take it, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Now, partisan liberty for all. How about fuck the orders of the police officers and fuck the compliance of the police officers to, I guess, respond to the quote in my intro that I still need to update that. I haven't updated that in a while, but to improve the sound. But welcome to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I am your host, Dave Bourne, and it is Tuesday, May 26, 2015, the day after what is known as Memorial Day. I almost said Labor Day. I was thinking Labor Day for a sec, which maybe actually be a better holiday because I think it actually celebrates people's labor, I guess. I don't know. But depending on what you're doing, you know, it might not be a positive thing neither. So tonight we're going to talk all about Memorial Day, which is supposedly the day to memorialize everyone that has died in all of these wars. Now, there's maybe one or two wars that you can look at and look at people as heroes, but there's a bunch of them where I'm sure that their intentions were good. Well, I don't even want to say that because I'm sure there are fucking lunatics who join the military who actually just want to kill people. And not that I'm saying that's the majority of people. I think you have a lot of people that go out there and they really believe that somehow they're helping their country. And how they come to that conclusion, I don't know. You know, with all the propaganda and stuff like that, obviously, that feeds into it. But we will be talking all about that and more. So thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All on weekdays, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen on Spreaker and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. We promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do what you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, as well as exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force. As all governments are based on power, control, and ruling over others, and achieve this through violence and force. And that's pretty much the definition of government. It was funny, today I caught some of Mark Levin, the guy who always talks about the Constitution, and I need to talk about the Constitution and all of these bad people that the Obamas and the whatever, I don't know. And so, you know, he I mentioned this before, worked in the Reagan administration. And it's funny how this motherfucker will go and talk about freedom, but will praise Reagan, who, as I have said before, had probably done just as much damage, if not more, than any other president in history. If you really look at the drug war and the people's lives that were not only taken, people that were killed, but the people's lives that were ruined because of that. And I guess he didn't technically start it, but he's the one who really, you know, took it to the next level. So with that, I'd like to introduce our Tuesday co-host who joins us every Tuesday, although he was off last week taking care of his paying job responsibilities, live from Orlando, Pete Murtha. Pete, thanks as always for joining us.
Thanks, Dave. It's great to be back again, and looking forward to this episode. It's I was you take 1 week off, it feels like it's a month and a half, but it's and so much happens on the news, it's hard to kind of compress it all back into one.
Yeah,
story.
It you know, when I was off for the week, when I was actually in Orlando, and then when I got back, I wasn't feeling well, so I took a couple of days off there, and I felt like I was off the air for like months. And, you know, it's really something that I realize that I do enjoy doing. And if I'm not doing it, it's like, you know, like a part of me's missing or something. So, yeah, it does feel like a while when I miss time. Now, this is something that is more, I guess, closer to you having served in the military, although you didn't serve in an actual war. And whatever happened to, because I remember a time when a veteran was considered a veteran of a war, where, you know, people were called veterans because they had served in a war. But now anybody who's ever been in the military technically is considered a veteran. And that might be because the United States is always at war, although they don't declare it, you know, so that might be there's a point taken there that they're always doing something. But do you remember where, you know, it was more people were called veterans of wars?
Well, you know, when I was enlisted, they said I was a veteran after serving 180 days, which I always thought was strange. I thought you had at least get out to be called a veteran. But when they told me that, I said, huh, okay.
180 days? Does that count weekends? Is that like business days?
Well, when you're enlisted, technically, you don't have a day off, or, you know.
Well, because that's not even a year.
No, that's 3 months.
So, hey, I was in the military 3 months and then I left. I just wanted to get my veteran status.
Yeah, so they said you had to at least serve that to be called a veteran. So, you know, it depends how much you want to whine about how hard boot camp was, because that was, you know, I don't know if that was included, because technically you're not in the military until you get out of boot camp.
How hard? I mean, that's a good point. Something that we never really talked about. And you know, of course, watching movies and all this stuff, it looks really hard. Is it as hard as, you know, you would think by watching these movies. And I guess we have to put it in perspective as well, because this was what, early 80s when you went through boot camp?
Right, right.
What I'm saying is it's probably not as hard now, I would think, as it was then, because political correctness and stuff like that, whether good or bad, I think has probably changed a lot of things. Or even, you know, compared to the 80s, maybe compared to like the 40s or something, probably the same thing, you know. But so what was your opinion on boot camp and how hard it was?
Well, you know, when you come out of a suburban upbringing and you get pushed into this, it seems hard. But they don't, you know, physically it's, well, first of all, I went there in the hottest summer they had since 1965. So it was over 90 degrees, you know, every day, and it was 100% humidity. So that was brutal. The heat was nuts.
And where was it that you attended?
I went to Paris Island. Yeah. I got to go to, you know, Pleasure Island in South Carolina.
Okay.
Which is really close to Hilton Head, which is where I would rather have spent my boot camp.
Well, that's actually where they have resorts.
Would have been on the beach. Yeah,
yeah, they have resorts in Hilton Head.
So Marines are on the beach, so that would have been great. But so yeah, it's hard. It is hard, but you know, I know people who went through Air Force boot camp and said it was hard. You know, and as a Marine, you only had to run 3 miles, which I thought was pretty light.
Well, when you say run, I mean, like jog, right? Because, I mean, I don't know anybody can really run 3 miles. Like, I don't think humans physically can, you know. I mean, what, the fastest guy in the world at one point, you know, could do a mile in like 4 minutes. And I remember in high school when I was 14 and 4 laps around the track was a mile, you know, and I ran the first lap and then I was like dead after that, and right. I was 14. So,
you know, we're Americans, we're not trained to be tough, right? So you know, when I ran my first mile, I was exhausted. I thought I was gonna die, and I ran it in like 8 minutes. So, you know, the fastest men had a few, you know, they were taking a break by the time I got to them. And now I'll tell you the max standards back then, and actually it's pretty close to that now. If you got 100% score for 3 different events, if you did this, if you could do 80 sit-ups in 2 minutes, you got a max score. If you did 20 pull-ups in as much time as you wanted, you got a max score. And if you could, now the running was graded, but the fastest I ever ran 3 miles in was like 18 and a quarter. So I was doing pretty good clips, and I guess I got, you know, like 90% for that. I think if you ran it in like 18 minutes, you were like 100%, and I couldn't quite get there.
That doesn't seem that. I mean, for me, the hardest part would be the running, because I always had like a touch of asthma, and I just, you know, I would probably suffocate. As far as like the toughness part, like I could fucking take a beating and shit, but I don't think that's really what you were doing.
You couldn't run for one.
Yeah, I would rather probably like say, okay, instead of running the 3 miles, can you just have like 3 dudes just like, you know, fight me for like 5 minutes and, you know, until I pass out or something.
That would be a great option, because I'm sure a lot of guys would have taken it. But no, if you look at it as a holistic, you know, sense of conditioning, that's good conditioning. But you're talking, that's a max score. If you look on the low side of it, you were required back then, and you could probably Google this, but you had to do at least 3 pull-ups. You had to do at least 40 sit-ups. And you had to run the 3 miles. Okay, I'm using run loosely.
I can do 3 pull-ups now. If you're talking about, like, I have this thing that goes on the, I don't know if you've ever seen these, you can buy them and put them on your door handle, like, and you can do pull-ups on your door.
Right.
And it's like the same shit. I mean, I can do that now. So I don't know about.
You could probably join the Marine Corps in your bedroom then.
Well, I mean, I can't do it. Like I said, the running, I'd run like, you know, a quarter of a mile and I'd be dead. So yeah, running, that would work out.
Well, that's the Marine Corps standards, okay? Every other service steps down from there.
So basically what you're telling me is it's the shit that you see. Well, wait, but the shit that you see in the movies is not is a lot harder than the reality, is what it sounds like.
Oh, no. See, the movies can't, you know, if you want to watch the best movie from Marine Corps boot camp, go out and rent Full Metal Jacket.
Well, I've seen it plenty of times.
That's the best. That is the best representation because it's not.
So most people blow their brains out after boot camp.
There's always guys trying to kill themselves. Some people try to fake kill themselves, you know,
just to get out.
Well, one guy tried slitting his wrist and they can't. They talked to us about it and they said, "Look, this idiot slit his wrist across his wrist." Now they go, "If you're going to kill yourself, first of all, don't use a safety razor because it doesn't work."
Straight.
And they said, second of all, cut your arm up laterally, from the wrist up. That way you will bleed to death and we won't have to write out reports about, you know, why you're a mental case. So that was our pep talk because someone tried to kill himself.
Well, people don't know something that I had learned. Brian Sovereign, who does a radio show, Sovereign Tech, where he talks all about technology and was a Sunday co-host of Free Talk Live, he joined, I'm thinking the Army, but it could have been the Marines. I can go back and listen to the interview. I mean, I did a 3-hour, you know, the whole show interviewing him because he was just had so much stuff to talk about and it was really interesting. And one of the things that he had said, and this is how he left after 2 years, and he left as a conscientious objector. Now, I don't know if that's a newer thing because, you know, obviously this is in the past 10 years or whatever. But he was able to leave that way. And some people, I guess, will get a, you know, the whatever they call it that's bad when you're...
There's two bad ones.
The dishonorable, yeah. He still got an honorable discharge because I guess, you know, from the work he was doing and they wanted him to advance and other things. And you can tell that he's a pretty smart guy. So I could definitely see them wanting him to get involved in a lot of, you know, technology type things and all of this stuff. And I guess he just got to a point where some of the stuff that he had seen, it's just he didn't want anything to do with it anymore. But how he had got out.
Yeah, that's a good way to get out is to just object to it, you know, because some of the stuff is just absolutely awful. You know, they give you orders to do things that is just inhuman. And you know, personally, I think they shouldn't be followed. They should just say no. And you can give all kinds of reasons of why it should be done. But you know, if you lose the face of your humanity to do those things, and you're trying to justify it with, you know, freedom, it doesn't make any sense. You know?
And then that's of course the common theme. So especially after 9/11, and that's why, you know, regardless of what anybody says, that whether you think it was an inside job or it wasn't, you cannot dispute the fact that it was totally exploited, and it would make sense if it was an inside job because there was so much that the government got out of it that it definitely benefited them, however you want to look at it. So I don't want to sit here and debate, you know, what happened and, you know, whether the CIA was involved or, you know, crazy Cheney or whoever. But just the fact that it's easy to see how government, you know, whether setting up environments for things to flourish or, you know, doing them themselves to see how they can benefit. So, you know, something like 9/11 obviously benefited, and the whole thing was, you know, the big saying was support the troops. Even the people that didn't support the war would still say support the troops. I don't know if you remember that. That was a big thing maybe, you know, mid-2000s, that yeah, we don't support the war. You would have people protesting the war, but still saying, but we support the troops. And
it was their out, right?
It's if you think about it now, and I don't know if that's just because they felt like, hey, if we say we don't support the troops, people aren't going to support our cause. And you have all that, too. And that's something I really try to stay away from. And, you know, who cares? Because it's not like I have that many listeners anyway. But even if I did, is to just kind of, and everybody does this. If they're trying to accomplish a goal, they come up with, how do I accomplish this goal? So if you're a group of people that are saying, well, we want to get out of Iraq and Afghanistan, it sounds better to say, well, we support the troops, though. We just don't support this war, as opposed to coming out and saying, you know what? We don't only not support this war. Well, we don't support these fucking troops who actually joined up for this war as well. And because of what happened, looking at it as, oh, look, the United States was attacked. We need to get revenge. We need to get back at them. And it's funny, though, that all these other countries that have been bombed and thousands of people killed. And but, you know, if they try to do anything, they're bad. But, you know, well, if it's the U.S., it's OK. It's kind of crazy where there's that total double standard and the looking at it from only one side instead of really looking at it objectively, not just looking at it, well, I live in this country, so it's okay, whatever they do.
Well, you covered a lot of points there, Dave. I definitely want to talk about the 9/11 thing, but I'd like to do it at the end because it's a good wrap-up. But there's been a smokescreen laid down in front of everybody about, you know, supporting the troops because, you know, and it all comes out of the Vietnam thing where, you know, they said troops are treated badly and it wasn't their fault. And I don't have an argument with the fact that they were treated badly. I have an argument with the point that it has nothing to do with the action we're committing these troops to, whether
well,
it's
justified Vietnam,
or not.
Though, one of the things about Vietnam is people were drafted. So Vietnam, in a sense, is a totally different thing there because if you're talking about people even not wanting to go, and I know some people just went to Canada, but I don't know that I blame the people that were drafted that went, and because they were put in that position. So I don't look at them the same way I would look at somebody joining now, because they're not being drafted. They're choosing to join. There's so much more information out there about what goes on and how these wars have nothing to do with freedom. And obviously Vietnam had nothing to do with the freedom of the U.S. It had to do with, we got to save the world from communism because, and look how that worked out, obviously.
Well,
you know,
that was what they said it was for, and it had nothing to do with it.
Right. But that's, you know, and
that's the best spin you could put on it.
And it
wasn't even true.
And they didn't, you know, win anyway, or at least from what they said, whatever their objective was, how that, you know, and that was before I was born, and how that went on, I have no fucking idea. I just can't see the same thing going on now, but you know, I could be wrong.
It's a lot like now is,
because that was but that was a civil war. You know, there wasn't really, I know there was a couple, incidences there. What, like the Gulf of Tonkin? Was that the,
that was fake though.
Yeah. But was, yeah, no I know, but I mean, there was a couple incidences that they
that
exploited.
Was the thing that they said. That's why LBJ said we can go in now. Cause there's a
right.
Gulf
right.
Of Tonkin. I mean,
but
they
exploited it.
Entryway.
Right. But what I'm saying is, you know, they entered into some fucking civil war and somehow were able to even draft people into it at the same time. And, you know, it's one thing for the shit to go on now with Iraq and ISIS, who is basically, you know, funded by the U.S. government, as far as, you know, I see it, and to go in and do whatever in the Middle East. But they're not drafting anybody. I just can't see them getting to a point now of drafting people and anybody being drafted actually fucking going, and there not being a total revolt there. But I don't know, you know, could be totally wrong. And maybe all they would have to do, I don't think they could do it in the same fashion, I guess. Like, they'd have to pull something like another 9/11 to do it.
Well, I don't know if they're going to. I mean, but the difference now is that we weren't in an economic depression. We were not in a depression in the 60s and 70s. And so we didn't have that problem going on with that. So now we're in a depression.
Supposedly we're not in a depression now neither. Right. Now that's, of course, depending on who you talk to. But right. According and to the president and his minions, no, the economy, everything's going great.
Right, right. So you have this huge problem with the economy. And when you talk to people who are going to go in and talk about going in, two big reasons they go in are they want a job and they want training. And the military has both, and they pay you while you train. All right. And I don't know if you've talked to people who are in right now, but the living standards are great. You have to earn probably about $40,000 a year to live as well as, say, a corporal or a sergeant. And if you're an officer,
you don't live too well off $40,000 a year. I don't know.
Well, they get their housing paid for. They get their food paid for. If they move out of the barracks and they're after a certain rank, or depending on where they're stationed, they get their housing paid for. And
well,
they get
okay, yeah.
Allowances.
If you're saying like they get $40,000 a year and basically, you know, that's just extra money, you know, then okay, then that's a whole nother story. But.
Well, when you get paid, right? Say you just live in a barracks on a base, okay, and you're getting your salary. You don't have to spend any money on anything except to repair your uniforms and get a haircut. Well, your food is there.
Dates and hookers and whatever else.
Well, you know, there's extras, but I knew guys. I knew one guy. He was so fanatical about his savings that he spent $20 a paycheck, and his only luxury was he would buy a box of Twinkies. That was the only luxury. He basically sat around the barracks, ironed his uniforms, and polished his boots. And the thing that worked for him with that is that's how you get promoted in the service. You study the manuals, you ace all your classes, and you polish your boots and press your clothes and learn everything you have to
and,
learn about the
you
military.
Know, you obey and you're obedient, whatever. But right. The things that
and
you're
you
doing
living.
Are contributing to just because you're not the person pulling the trigger does not mean that you're not culpable to all of these things that happen. I mean, you're part of that whole thing. So if you're in the mafia, you know, just because you're not the guy who did the hit, does that mean you don't have any responsibility?
Well, you know, I think the one listener you had just had an aneurysm when you compared the military to the mafia, but I get where you're coming from. No, you know, that's where I said before is when, you know, people are ordered to do things that are absolutely hideous. I don't believe you should follow those orders when they're that evil, you know.
Well, they know the result is going to be that they're probably going to end up in jail, in a military
It depends
prison.
What they're – I'll tell you what. I know someone whose brother walked out of the Air Force because he found out that the simulated drone attacks they were doing
weren't
they were actually killing
were real
people.
Right, yeah.
They were real people, and he just walked away, and they have not come after him since. And it's been like 6 to 8 years since he did that.
Well,
because
maybe
he knows what they were doing.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Yeah. Maybe that's why, because maybe there's some agreement there that, hey, if you, you know,
what we talk were doing about this. Was totally against the law then, yeah. And there's no way they could.
Well, obviously he told somebody because he you know about it. But
no, he it was a family member who told me about it, and you know, they so you know, it, but that's risky, but you know, it actually just it fruited the guy out. I mean, he just lost. He's never been the same since because he was a good person who thought he was serving his country to protect the people of his country and promote freedom.
But how are you
democracy throughout the world?
And this is one of the things I want to get to. How the fuck are you protecting anybody? So we could go through every single war, and I'm not an expert in all these wars, and I know neither are you. But talk about now and talk about, you know, the past, at least the last two centuries, you know, counting this new century, which is only, you know, 15 years into it. But what has been done that has protected the freedom of anybody within the U.S. at all, period?
Well, there's only two wars, I think, that were justified, and there's a big distinction about them from every other war we've been in, and I would debate the big one anytime, but the Revolutionary War, we were protecting ourselves from an absolutely, you know, barbaric tyrant. You know, a completely ruthless person.
Yeah, but that was like a totally different. And I agree with you. That was definitely a war for independence and
self-defense,
freedom.
Right?
But it was a totally different war because you weren't even dealing with, you know, an established nation or which might in some ways is a good thing. But yeah, so I mean, I don't think anybody's going to argue that. But that's, you know, not in the last two centuries. That's, you know, before that. So
that's a ways away.
So
and earlier you mentioned the War of 1812, and I agree with you on that.
And that's debatable. Supposedly, you know, I've heard different things, and I honestly don't know enough about, you know, I remember studying it in school years ago, and that England, you know, attacked. Because that's when the White House got burnt down. And
yeah, they burned everything down in D.C., right?
Yeah, and so...
Yeah, we were attacked on that one.
But I don't know. Yeah, but then there's always these things that lead to wars that we're not privy to. So that's the whole thing where I've heard different things regarding that. But obviously, you know, it did take place within the United States, and definitely if you're attacked... you have the right to defend yourself. So, you know, give them that one as well. I mean, then you have the Spanish-American War, which is, I don't know, you had in between then wiping out Indians, which I don't know that it really was a war. But at least anything before, I believe, World War One. Was all within the United States, or I guess you could technically say territory that they wanted, but it was in, you know, and some of those wars I wouldn't defend, and some of the stuff they did, you know, with the Native Americans and stuff like that. But I think you can say, and again, not knowing enough about the specifics and everything behind, you know, because you get one version of history. And then you get a bunch of other things that are kind of left out. So once you get to World War One, that's where the U.S. says, hey, not only are we going to be involved in every fucking war, but we're going to have all these covert actions going on and all of these other things and putting in, you know, dictators in different places and installing rulers and all of that stuff, too. So it went way beyond even wars. And some of the stuff that they did caused future wars. And you ever think about or you've ever played the game of chess? I'm sure you have and you're familiar with chess. where they say, you know, like a great chess player, I don't know the exact number, but they can think, you know, like whatever, 10, 20 moves ahead. And
yeah,
that
amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. And, with one of the shows I was watching and, I still haven't finished watching it, like House of Cards, it's kind of the same way where, you know, politically they're thinking all of these moves ahead to kind of get to this end game. And, you know, you don't know where that starts and what's part of that. And at the same time, you know, you're also calculating, well, you think they're going to do this, but in case they do this, you know, you have a backup plan for that and all of these things. So really what I'm saying with that is the fact that there are all these inside things that we just don't know. We get the bullshit, you know, whatever they can say is an actual fact. Oh, this battle was fought here, whatever, and this side won. And after the war, they signed this treaty and this country became this. And, you know, the things like that. But what led up to things and a lot of things that were going on, yeah, there's a lot more information about that now, but you have to go and kind of look for it. And it's not something, you know, I'm not some historian on wars that the U.S. has been in. But I can say that something like World War One. Now, first of all, if you read G. Edward Griffin's book about the Federal Reserve, which we've talked about on the show, what he had said, and this is, of course, a speculation, that World War One was all about interest to J.P. Morgan because England was basically maxed out credit-wise. They couldn't afford to even make interest payments on the money that was owed to J.P. Morgan. And I guess it must have been some kind of law where in order for the U.S. to give England money to support them in a war, that they had to enter the war. So supposedly that was all agreed upon, and that's why they entered the war. The fact about borrowing the money and owing interest, I think, is a fact, is indisputable. Now, the other part of it, I guess it's speculative, but
I can't believe, Dave, that you would honestly believe that they would go to war because somebody was broke. I really believe it was for that poor Duke somebody who meant nothing. Yeah,
Francis Ferdinand, who was assassinated. That's what they'll teach you in school. What they'll teach you in school, and I don't know what they teach you now, but yeah, is the Archduke, the Archbishop or whatever he was, the Archduke Francis Ferdinand was assassinated, and all of a sudden, now there's a world war. Obviously, that's a bunch of bullshit. There were all these other things going on at the time. But I mean, even never mind that. I mean, this was later, you know, a few years later when England was essentially broke. And you know, World War II, if you look at the end result of World War II and you look at how, you know, again, this is all speculative and who really knows, but the end result of World War II made the U.S. a world power with the majority of the gold, with the ability to now have the reserve currency. And if you think about that for a minute, you know, who knows how much of World War II was really orchestrated by the United States?
Well, yeah. I mean, I could talk.
It definitely was by businessmen. You had, like, Prescott Bush and all them fuckers, funding. You even had, I read Rockefeller's book, David Rockefeller, not the whole thing, but most of it. He was in Germany in, like, 1936, and he claims he was there for all these other reasons. I mean,
look at Germany. Ahead. They were broke and on their backside, and all of a sudden, all this money via credit, you know, surfaces for them to build up a giant military juggernaut. How did that happen?
You're right. The last time I checked, didn't they lose World War One?
Weren't they
one of the countries
they were so restricted in World War One that they couldn't make heads or tails economically. And all of a sudden they come up with all this cash to kind of sounds like China, right? Somebody funded them. And then on our side, we made it brutal on the Japanese by cutting them off from natural resources and driving them into inflationary, you know, currency wars so that they couldn't defend themselves against.
So,
it was completely provoked. You know, if there's a bigger person in the room and they keep taking up more of the oxygen in the room, at some point you're either going to have to say, well, I'll just roll over and die, or you're going to fight back. And then they can say, well, you know, he took a swing at this guy. You know, and it's ridiculous. You know, my favorite example of this is Pearl Harbor. And, you know, you got to really, I don't know how you could ever prove to me that nobody realized that the entire, like, Japanese fleet sailed out completely armed for war from Japan. How could you miss that?
Well, I thought that's even been admitted that Roosevelt knew that was going to happen.
It wasn't just him.
I'm sure it was other people. But what I'm even saying that the possibility, you know, like I was saying, like a chess game. I mean, at what point was it orchestrated from the very beginning by some of the powers that be? Was it, you know, certain things happened and as things happened, you know, they developed into that? Because, like I said, the one fact that you cannot argue is that the United States was not a world power until after World War II. And the amount of gold, I mean, they had more gold than anybody, and they were able to. Now, the U.S. dollar was able to become the reserve currency, and it has been pretty much ever since. And that was one of the reasons why. So what I'm saying is that something that was planned, you know, back in 1936 or something? Or was it something that kind of just evolved and they used different things to their advantage as they happened? And, you know, with some of the buildup of, like you're saying, you know, for Germany not having money and obviously being built up by all these other millionaires as well, you know, and I also read the book The Rise of the Fourth Reich by Jim Mars, who wrote the book that the JFK movie was based on. One of them, there was actually, I think, two books. You know, and he basically said that was more of an experiment there that it never went away. They just imported it to the United States. And there's a lot of information that supports that. You know, not only all of the, you know, German scientists and all that, but all of the things that have happened regarding, you know, the United States becoming that type of country that, you know, with government rule and controlling everything and all of that.
Well, you know, have you read or it's by Smedley Butler?
I'm familiar with all that supposedly was a military coup that they wanted him to be a part of, and he kind of blew the whistle.
Yeah. I mean, the book he wrote. He wrote a book.
I didn't read the book, no.
Called War is a Racket. I'll just read the first sentence out of it. Maybe we could read a little more. It's about a nice paragraph. But his first opener is, I spent 33 years and 4 months in active military service. And during that period, I spent most of the time as a high-class muscle man for big business, for Wall Street, and the bankers.
And he wrote
In short, I was a racketeer, a gangster for capitalism. And then he lists what he did during that time. Of what he did during that time.
Well, I think
that's the highest decorated Marine Corps. The highest decorated officer in the history of the military.
But 2 points. I think that was sometime in the 1930s or something that he wrote that, or was it later?
He was at the turn of the 19th century and forward. And you know, so he was pre-World War I. He was involved.
No,
in
but
Central
I thought
America,
he wrote that
China.
Book later. You know, like
I think 33 he wrote it.
Yeah, so that's kind of what.
And yeah,
what
I'm right.
So
what said.
So but I know there were comments that, well, he was a big communist and whatever, and not that that makes a makes a difference.
Any, but yeah, they, when someone that might be trying to
demonize, yeah, the ways to demonize people. But yeah, I mean, look at him saying that back then, and it's pretty obvious that's what it is now. And so that's really, you know, the whole point here is we're sitting there. Well, not we, because I'm not fucking celebrating shit. But all of these people that died in all of these wars. And, of course, it's sad for anybody to die for any reason. I'm not saying, oh, you should be happy that people died in these wars. But they're being looked at as heroes. And at the same time, there's plenty of people that die. I think in the United States alone, it's something like 2.5 million people every year die. And there's a whole day that celebrates people that, you know, have died in wars. And we're talking about a lot of these wars, the majority of them, really not being or having anything to do with fighting for freedom. And in some circumstances, not being heroes, but being villains. And I want to get more into that. But I want to take a break first. And then when we come back, we can maybe get more into some of the wars that we were talking about. And especially at least the ones of maybe the last 50 or 100 years. And really looking at, you know, what is a hero and what is fighting for freedom? You know, do I see the military protecting me when a cop is fucking, you know, kneeing me in my back and kidnapping me and abusing me? Because that's the freedom that I want that I'm not seeing. So anyway, we will be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. You can actually call in if you want to join the discussion or get mad and like yell at me or something at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. I hope I have the number right because I hadn't mentioned it in a while. You can also Skype in as well, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And of course, check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. and on Spreaker, and we will be right back after this.
When you think about driverless vehicles, you most likely think about Google. The company has put its stamp on the revolutionary technology that's expected to act both as your car and as your chauffeur. But even though Google has the most notable driverless car, it's certainly not the only driverless vehicle on the market. Defense industry heavyweight Lockheed Martin has just wrapped testing on a slightly bigger driverless prototype. It looks a little something like this. Yes, that's a military truck. At demonstrations earlier this month at Fort Hood, Texas, the U.S. Army and Lockheed Martin showed off their new system that allows Army convoys to operate independently in foreign urban environments. Using something called the Autonomous Mobility Applique System, or the AMAS, the vehicles can dodge pedestrians as well as navigate oncoming traffic, road intersections, and stalled vehicles. This advanced system is all a result of an $11 million contract between the Army.
A thoughtful, fact-based debate.
And Lockheed Martin, wherein the defense contractor is developing low-cost sensors that can be attached to existing Army machinery. Without a driver, the trucks will be able to enter foreign areas and combat zones without having to worry about the danger of risking American soldiers' lives. However, if desired, the vehicles can still be manned. In that case, the truck would alert the soldier to any safety threats, and then the driver would have the ability to stop, adjust, or take full control of the vehicle. But the AMAS system only moves the military closer to its goal of capitalizing on autonomous warfare. Last month at the Army Aviation Symposium, an officer announced that the Army was looking to slim down its personnel numbers and adopt more robots over the coming years. The officer was suggesting that the Army move to incorporate the Robot Mule, an autonomous vehicle that can transport supplies and heavy loads for soldiers. But as we've learned in recent months, it goes far beyond that. Take a look at this animation from Sandia National Laboratories. This is the future of automated drones, a single unmanned vehicle that can fly, swim, drive, and even jump 30 feet into the air. This is being developed right now. The government contractor says it hopes the device will one day carry out missions usually reserved for special operation forces. So from automated trucks to mules to drones, unmanned and autonomous systems are no longer a technology of the future, at least not for the U.S. military, which is seemingly moving to prepare for war in the robotic age. In Washington, Amira David, RT.
Obama again warned today of the growing threat of extremism around the world. At a White House-sponsored conference, Andy urged the global community to do more to stop it.
Countries have a responsibility to cut off funding that fuels hatred and corrupts young minds and endangers us all.
The president shifted his focus overseas today before an audience of ministers from around the world. He placed special emphasis on the role democracy plays in fighting terrorism, a theme often heard from his predecessor, George W. Bush.
When dissent is silenced, it feeds violent extremism. It creates an environment that is ripe for terrorists to exploit. When peaceful democratic change is impossible, it feeds into the terrorist propaganda that violence is the only answer available.
Mr. Obama also urged leaders to expand human and religious rights as they confront extremist ideologies from groups like Islamic State. Also key, fostering economic and educational opportunities for young people who may be receptive to the militants' call. Delegates from 65 countries also heard from UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon.
We will never find our ways by discarding our moral compass. We need cool heads, we need common sense, and we must never let fear rule.
He pressed for alternatives to purely military responses.
It is all about education, education, education. Opportunity, 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 empowerment, empowerment, empowerment.
Jordan's foreign minister Nasser Judeh vowed his country will lead the fight against extremists, a role that has stepped up since the execution by burning of a Jordanian pilot by Islamic State.
If anyone had any doubt about the brutality and barbarism of these extremists, then this doubt has been removed. If anyone had any doubt that this is our war as Muslims and our collective war as an international community, that doubt has been removed.
And as Europe reels from a spike in homegrown terrorism and its own citizens leaving to join Islamic State and other groups, the French Interior Minister highlighted the different pathways leading people toward extremism, including social media.
The profile of terrorists and potential terrorists is very diversified now. Many have access to the internet and learning on the internet. They go abroad and they are trained to kill when they come back to Europe. They go from criminality to terrorism. In prison, they have contact with extreme terrorists.
Private meetings among the ministers were held throughout the day as they search for a full spectrum response to a complex, bedeviling challenge.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All and nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And we are back. Today we're talking all about Memorial Day and the purpose of Memorial Day and why we memorialize people as heroes for things that I would say the majority of them are not really protecting anybody's freedom. We have talked a little about this in the past. I know, Pete, we had done a show a while ago just about does the military protect our freedom, which ultimately we came to the conclusion that they don't. But as far as talking about Memorial Day and this whole celebration, and I don't know what other countries do. And if they do things like this, I would think that they got them from the United States. But it seems like the U.S. is, if there's such a word, is over patriotic. It's just ridiculous, you know, whether it's at a sporting event or even high school sporting event or whatever, that you always get these celebrations of the flag, which I really see as celebrations of government. And before we get more into, you know, some of these wars and how really the only thing they protect are the interests of politicians, I wanted to talk a little about that as well. As, you know, is that just another tool of propaganda to keep reinforcing the flag and, you know, having the flag everywhere? I mean, how many places do you see the flag? Any government building, you see a flag. High schools, elementary schools, you see them at high school sporting events, any other sporting events. And really, what is the, I guess, kind of obsession really with constantly celebrating what I would say is government? And with that, how do people separate it? So you have some people that say, that would say they're patriotic, and that I love America, but I don't like the government, or I like, you know, some type of phrase like that, which I really don't understand. I don't see them as separate, because what is America without the government? That's what it is. I don't know, Pete, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, it's complicated. The flag is used as a rally point, right? And it is supposed to be a visual representation of the Constitution.
Is that so? Sorry, say that first part again.
It's a visual representation of the Constitution.
What, the flag?
Yeah, that's the way I always saw it. And, you know, you look to America and the flag represents that liberty and freedom and, you know, that typical.
Well, the Constitution technically doesn't even represent that, but okay. Which.
What do you mean? One star, free state, on a field of blue.
Well, what about the fact that the government was overthrown? People tend to forget about that. There was the Articles of Confederation, right? Wasn't that overthrown by the Constitution? Didn't a group of people essentially overthrow the government?
Are you talking about when they formed the Constitution?
Yeah.
Yeah, there were, you know,
you had the Articles of Confederation.
Of the Constitution, how it was, yeah, it was a confederation of states.
Well, no, but well, you had the, it was the Articles of Confederation was the governing document. And that, and again, I'm far from an expert on this, but from what I understand is that the Articles of Confederation was a governing document which gave a lot more power to the states, and they didn't like that, and it was essentially overthrown with the Constitution.
Yeah, there were some people, original founders, who were vehemently against the Constitution, and the Articles the Bill of Rights was put in there to kind of stop a complete, like, some people would not
they
agree
weren't going
to
ratify it
unless
yeah.
that was in there
yeah
because it curbed the government
Although it didn't seem to do anything in the long term.
No, because of the people that were, you know, put in place through money and influence. And, you know, it's a long chain of events. But, you know, the bankers have, you know, won their case or are winning their case. You're seeing where it leads to now. No freedom, no hope of, you know, real economic liberty. And you're owned by, you know, more and more corporations. So, you know, this is the end result. And it wasn't supposed to be that way. But little by little, they chipped away at the different pieces that protected us. And and they used the Constitution to ram it down your throat.
And as you know, I disagree with that because I think at the beginning, it was still obviously, you know, and yes, it's like moving forward, you know. If you're climbing a staircase, you know, you're taking one step at a time. But what I'm saying is they were already up one staircase already when it was written in the first place. And
they
just had more and more staircases to go up. So
it was done to enable this whole thing, right?
So really, and that makes sense what you're saying, that, you know, waving the flag or having the flag in front of your, like those people that have it like on their fucking, you know, porch or whatever, or right near their door, and that they're looking at it. I'm patriotic, and this is, stands for freedom and whatever. But in reality, it doesn't, because what it stands for is the government. And even if you say it stands for the Constitution, what do you think the government is, or what it was supposed to be, is the Constitution. So why should anybody celebrate government, no matter how great you think your government is? I think you should never celebrate government. You should always be on the lookout for, you know, I don't think their government should exist in the first place. But let's say, you know, whatever, if you have a government, that you should always be on the lookout for, you know, what it can do. You should never be celebrating government at all, period.
No, right. So, you know what it's kind of like? I just had this thought. You know how when you watch, if you ever watch a NASCAR race at the end, and they interview the winner, and what does he do? He thanks a litany of sponsors, right? So he's talking about the great race, and Pepsi, I guess he can't thank them in one sentence, but he thanks all his sponsors, you know, Motocraft, you know, UPS, whoever. So when you say, you know, remember the fallen, remember the veterans, support America, you know, you're really kind of going through a list of sponsors. And it's like a knee-jerk thing that's done. And the people have nothing to do with the government. So our freedom isn't based on the government. It's based on us. And we've let that just deteriorate. And we were kind of outmaneuvered, you know, because we were fooled by this slick, you know, nifty presentation of history that isn't true. We've kind of gone along with it because some aspects of our lives seem a lot better because we've gone along with this.
Well, I think some people were fooled a lot more than others.
Most people are completely fooled, right?
Well, I mean, you know, like I think for myself, and I'm not, you know, just saying this as, oh, well, I knew, you know, all this, because I didn't know all of this, definitely. But I was definitely a lot further in what I thought than a lot of people. You know, where I never believed in political parties. I always thought, since I could remember, that drugs should be legal, that guns, you know, should be legal, you know, all of these things. Now, the whole thing of we shouldn't have a government and all of that, you know, it's hard to get to that point because you constantly have it shoved in your face. But you have people that are totally like when... And this is not saying, well, I am smarter or I'm better or anything like that at all. It's just, I think, kind of the way I grew up compared to, say, the way you grew up was, you know, you grew up more from a conservative religious family, and that's just kind of, you know, you had all those influences where I think maybe I think I was just born as a person that I just question everything and don't fucking tell me what to do. But I mean, at the same time, and when I think about it, I would probably say if I had to define my father politically, I mean, maybe he was a libertarian, you know what I mean? So that probably helped as well. I mean, he thought all drugs should be legal also. So I think it's also that factors into it as well. But yeah, it takes, no matter who it is, I don't think anybody just comes out born like as well, you know, I don't need a government to rule me. I can rule myself. You know, I think it's a process that for some people it takes longer than others, and some people it takes never. It doesn't happen, unfortunately.
Well, I mean, actually, Dave, you know, there are a lot of people who don't wake up in the morning and even give the government a thought. Seriously, I'm not disagreeing with you. It's just that this group of people won't do a thing. They're just kind of living in the cracks.
Well,
eking out their living. And
are you talking about the people, sorry to interrupt, but are you talking about the people that are just trying to live free and saying, well, fuck them because I'm just going to do what I'm going to do? Or are you just talking about people that are just totally oblivious?
Because
I think there's both. Well, I think couple kinds of people that fit into that category, because I think you have people that really do maybe aware of, yeah, you know, the government this and the government that, but you know what? I'm just going to live as free as I can. Fuck them. I'm going to do what I'm going to do. And, you know, what happens, happens. As opposed people that are just totally oblivious and, you know, I got to follow the law. I don't want to get in trouble or whatever.
But they're oblivious to the tyrannical part.
Well, when I say oblivious, I mean to the tyrannical part, that they just think, hey, as long as I just obey the laws, you know, everything's going to be okay. And, you know, again, compared to the people that are just saying, hey, you know what? I'm just going to live free. Because it can be, and I've experienced this myself as well, it can be very fucking disturbing, you know, when the more you think about it. Because really what you're in is just a much larger cage than what you're in a jail cell. Yes, it is a lot larger. You know, there's a huge difference. But there's not as much of a difference as you really think there is.
No, it's true. It's true. The scope of freedom you could have, it really brings it actually to the same size. You know, when you really want it to, when you get an idea to do something that's, you know, really exercises your freedom in a real way, you watch how fast, you know, government wakes up and says, oh, wait a minute, you know, we're going to take care of that. That's not going to happen.
Yeah, as long as you stay in line. And sometimes even when you don't stay in line, you have to worry about stuff. But for the most part, as long as you're totally obedient and you stay in line and you do what they want you to do, then, you know, for the most part, you'll probably be okay. But that's not even always the case neither. You know, you can just be minding your own business and shit happens to people all the time. So I'm sure you have so many stories of people that said, hey, I thought if I was just a law-abiding citizen that everything would be all right. You know, they get raped by a cop or something, or, you know, they're beaten by them or whatever.
Oh, some of the really big activists, people who do monumental things and really stand up to government, some of those people were absolutely oblivious to any kind of tyranny going on. And then they ran into the backside of the bear and got its attention. And they didn't see it coming. And those particular people I'm talking about decided to stand their ground And they're very talented and very brilliant people, but they had no idea this was going on. You know, the woman who wrote the book on Agenda 21, you know, she wasn't sitting around saying, I need to make sure America's free. You know, she totally ran into this thing by accident and goes after it. She's a pit bull, you know, but she was one of these oblivious people. But then there's people who are really brilliant and figure it out and just navigate through it, living their lives free, you know, picking the safest roads to take so that, you know, they don't stick their head up too far. But, you know, they pretty much, you know, they don't celebrate Memorial Day. They don't celebrate government holidays except for, you know, they have to, well, you know, they can't mail a post on that day. But they, you know, they ignore the whole red, white, and blue thing. And they know it's a racket, you know, but they're just, they know that if they stick their head up, they add risk to their lives. So they take the low road, the easier road, and they go, you know, I don't have a stake in this. You know, I'm just going to operate inside this big prison as affluently as I can. And they just accept that.
But I think at some point, and this is why, you know, because I used to be more like, I just got frustrated with stuff. And it's just like, you know what, fuck it. I'm not going to bother with this shit. I'm just going to do my own thing. You know, if something happens, I'll just be prepared for whatever. Well, as prepared, I guess, as you can be. But you get to a point where, you know, you can only, like, lay low for so long until something's going to affect you or somebody you care about. And, you know, people can continue to try to ignore stuff and avoid it and just pretend that everything is great. But eventually it's going to affect them in some way. And one of the things that the government does try to do is make you think when you're the victim that you're actually the bad person, that you're the criminal.
Yeah.
And a lot of people buy into that. So they don't feel like they've been victimized by the government. They feel like, oh, well, I did something wrong and they just did what they, you know, should do. But getting back to with Memorial Day and having all these people that will, you know, celebrate government and try to, and they even, they'll try to separate it, because if you listen to them talk about it and they'll say that, well, you know, I don't necessarily approve of my government, but I love my country. And, you know, breaking that down, what does that really mean? Because what is a country, first of all? Well, I would define a country as imaginary borders that is ruled over by some kind of government. I mean, what else is it?
That's basically it. I mean, you know, it's the borders are made up. I mean, how many countries, just to go at your point, how many countries had their borders obliterated, you know, by what would you call it? Artificial, you know, boundaries, right? Where it really wasn't a legitimate boundary. It was made up by countries like Britain, right? Who just decided, you know, you're going to have this problem here now because we want your stuff, and that's the way it's going to go down. We make up new religions. You know, we create sects that don't mean anything. You know.
I had mentioned this last week, I think, when you were off. I think it was when Ken was on it. England really is probably, at least, you know, in the past, whatever, 500 years, the worst or evilest, if that's a word, country that existed. Because if you look at all the connections to Britain, and I was mentioning how, you know, I bought some Canadian gold, and who's on the back of it? Well, Queen Elizabeth.
Yeah.
Because they all still have connections to England. It's like still a giant empire, whether people realize it or not. And it's crazy.
They are the head of the mafia. England never loses. They're doing things right now to make sure that, you know, they're going to be tucked and tied away, and you know that the monarchy is going to be preserved, you know, when all hell breaks loose coming up here. So they're they're a unique kind of bastard, right? And they hide themselves. I mean, they oh my God, they act like they. Did you see that? I'm not getting off topic here. Did you see the Planet of the Apes, the latest one that came out?
Well, there were a few of them, but if you're talking about the one, the Dawn of the Planet of the Apes with Gary Oldman, and he's trying to keep things together, and they need to get into some thing to get power or something. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, do you remember the scene with the nemesis of the movie, who's an ape? You know, infiltrates the enemy camp, and he goes in there, and he's put at gunpoint by two armorers who are locked and loaded and can shoot him to pieces. And when he's cornered, what does he do? He does he gives him a big raspberry and acts like a fool.
Yeah.
Like a monkey. Yeah, and they go, oh, you're hilarious. All right. And they let him go. You know, he's there to do absolutely no good. And then the next time they see him, he does the same thing. He's like, oh, I'm the cute, funny, tumbling monkey. And then he just picks up a gun and kills them both.
Yeah.
So that's England. That's the royal monarchy. That's what they do. They make you think they're a little old hand-waving queen who's just, you know, so cute and adorable. And, you know, she can't do any, you know, this is just, we have to keep her in Buckingham Palace because she's just awesome. And what are they about? They're where all the power is. And they've got everybody fooled. And they got people saying, oh, God save the queen. And, you know, it's England, and it's garbage. It's not England. It's not them. It's not what they're about. You know, that's what they're about. And they're about ruling everybody.
Yeah, so, I mean, yeah, it's not everybody, you know, all the citizens of England. It's the ruling class of England. I guess even their accents sound non-threatening.
I think they do it in such a way where you're like, how could you be? You know, you can say things, if you say it in an American dialect, and, you know, it's absolutely crass. But when the English say it, I had a girlfriend who was English for like 5 years. And, you know, she could, when she used vulgarity,
she was English
adorable.
For 5 years, or you dated her for 5 years?
Dated her for 5 years? I don't know. Went out with her, whatever. A continuous date for 5 years.
Well, I was saying, you said
she
was
English or whatever.
She was English for 5 years. So she was English for 5 years and turned to like French.
Yeah, exactly. My point being, Dave, God, you'd love to hammer my phraseology, but it's true. It's terrible sometimes. But she could say the most crass thing.
Trying to put some inject some entertainment into the show.
Well, you know what they called the police? Their slang for it?
Pigs.
The filth.
Oh.
I've never heard you call the police anything that bad. That's what they called the police, the filth. I mean, you know.
I call them fucking criminals is what I call them.
Right. It's not as bad as the filth. Nobody wants to be filthy.
But
a lot of people will make a good living being criminals.
But so going back to this whole definition then, if we're saying that what is a country? Well, a country is a geographical area determined by imaginary lines, really, ruled over by a government, then how can you say, well, I don't support the government, but I love America. Now, I understand you could say I love the people, the normal people of America, or I love the terrain. Like, say, you know, Southern Nevada, I think is beautiful. I love the desert and the mountains and all that. But I mean, you know, I can probably see the same thing in part of Mexico too. But I don't say I love the government of America. So to say I love America, you know, I don't know, because I guess you can say that, well, I love the culture, or I love this, or I love that. But I don't think the flag represents that. I really don't. I think the flag represents the government and the landmass that they claimed is theirs.
Well, it's turned into that, right? I mean, they you know, it's a trick. It's a play on the mind that, you know, they think the flag stands for freedom, and what it really stands for is letting the government do what they want. And it's sad. I mean, if people really want to go, you know, if you want to take it all back, just fly the state flag and don't fly the American flag. You know, go back to, you know, like you said, the Confederation, and you know, dump this bureaucratic private corporation. But
why not get rid of flags altogether?
Freedom. It doesn't represent freedom, liberty, you know, at all. That's not what they're about. That's not what they're here for. I hope people can start realizing that. And the real tragedy that we're talking about tonight is that they've wrapped themselves inside of slain, you know, members of our society.
Well, they
talk about how noble it is.
They look at that as a total insult. I remember, it was either 1997 or 98. I wasn't going to do it, but I said, like, to my mom, I was like, I'm going to burn a fucking flag at the 4th of July parade. And I didn't think of doing it because I supported any other country or anything like that, because that's what they try to, say as well, that means, well, you have some allegiance to some other country and this whole bullshit thing. But no, as a protest, is to say, this is the government, and fuck what the government's doing, and fuck all the shit that you've done. And, you know, I bet you if I would have done that, I probably would have been jumped by 10 or 20 people, especially, knowing who I am.
Because of, you know, because of the experiences some people have had that are related to the flag, or they relate to the flag, yeah, they get very emotional about it.
They relate it to the flag. It's not related to the flag per se. It's they talk about it, because you'll hear them. Well, I fought, you know, I put my life on the line for that flag. I did this for that flag.
And those are the statements that get published, right?
Yeah. So, yeah, and going back to that, so first of all, and again, we did kind of do a show on this, but where is the, we protect your freedom, because it's non-existent. The only thing that you could say at the very minimum is that somehow maybe it's a deterrent to say that, well, no other country would attack the U.S. because of its military. But that's kind of irrelevant at this point, because nobody would attack the U.S. because they got a bunch of nuclear fucking weapons. Not only that, you have something like 300 million guns as well. So, you know, this whole idea, and that's, you know, they talk about the same people that talk about the Constitution. People just contradict themselves over and over again, because the same people that talk about the fucking Constitution, which basically said nothing about a military, it was supposed to be essentially a militia when people were needed, you know, because they got attacked, then they got together and fought back. Not a standing army like there is now, because what happens when you have a standing army? Well, we see what happens when you have a standing army. Then they use it to do their political biddings, interfere in all these other countries, use them to get what they want. And that's basically what they use them for. And I think that's what they've used them for at least 100 years, not just the past 10 or 20.
Oh, well, easily, yeah. Longer than that. I mean, we wouldn't have taken out Mexico, you know, and grabbed Texas if we didn't have, you know, well, I don't know if that was fought with the military.
But Texas was a little different, because I know they had their own kind of, yeah, I mean, their own independence going on there, you know, of people fighting back against Mexico. But it wasn't like the U.S. military. It was, you know, people, but I would, And again, there's probably a lot of things I don't know about this, but from what I understand with that story, I would look at it as actual people fighting for their freedom in a sense.
Yeah, sort of. So it's a bad example. It's not a good example.
But I know what you mean. Well, but I mean, then you had the Spanish-American War in like 1898 or whatever, where, you know, they took Southern California, Arizona, part of Nevada, New Mexico, and some of that land.
Right, and your point is all that's needed. With the amount of privates that are in this country, a foreign military coming in would have a ridiculously hard time trying to suppress the population. It would be impossible. You know, our military got kicked out of Baghdad because once, you know, we were in there and they figured out, you know, what we were doing, we couldn't defend ourselves anymore. So we had to leave because we were going to be slaughtered.
Think about that for a minute. If you look at what happened in Iraq, the fucking U.S. military, and I know that they put, you know, restraints on them and say they can't do this and they can't do that. And obviously it would be even worse to a bigger extent if like a state said we're leaving. But how the fuck, you know, how the fuck would the U.S. military be able to do anything? Never mind some other military, you know. So you're going to tell me, and now the thing is China. So, of course, on Drudge, there's something in some islands in China. And if something doesn't happen, war is inevitable, which I think is a bunch of bullshit. Because China and the U.S. know that if they go to war, it will probably wipe out, you know, the whole world essentially, and it's not going to happen. But I think it's good for people that write articles, and it's good to scare people.
Yeah, well, it's right. She's for control. So, and what does it do? It justifies the need for a giant ass military, doesn't it? But that's the problem. When you build these huge armies, you're making a ready use force for other people to take it over and use it for things that you had no intention of using it for, you know, because it was available. And, you know, if you had to start from scratch to raid Iraq, you know, back in the 90s, right, how hard would that have been if we didn't have a giant military developed by Reagan? And the answer is we would have had to call up a draft, you know, and because we had 500,000 troops there. If we had, talking about Desert Storm? Yeah, if we had a military of like 100,000 or 200,000 people, we could have never pulled that off. Because you couldn't have defended, you couldn't even have a defense force left in the U.S., period. Everyone would have had gone to Iraq that was in the military.
But see, right? I think the point is you don't need one. I mean, how many military bases are there around the world that we're aware of? Like 200 and something?
Oh, it's not. Yeah, and how many bones?
That we're aware, and I'm saying that we're aware of. Yeah.
Right.
So right, for so, what? I mean,
well,
what countries obvious, are even, right? If you look at all the countries in the world, and some of them don't even have militaries. Like from what I understood, Japan barely has a military. Some of these countries, they just rely on the U.S. to protect them. Who has a military, really? That's, I mean, you look at spending, the U.S. spends more money than like the top other 10, you know, militaries combined or something ridiculous like that. So who has a military that they didn't even have to worry about? What, Russia or China? And you know that any country with nuclear weapons, they're not going to go to war with. That's why they don't want some of these countries to get nuclear weapons. Not because they're actually scared that something's going to happen. It's what we can't fuck around with them anymore. And if I was any other country, I'd want nuclear weapons too, so they couldn't fuck around with me.
Right.
And that's really what it is.
Well, it puts them in a position of control and able to fend off the ultimate threat, right? Because, I mean, these countries want weapons so they can, you know, have a chance of, you know, repelling us or not being completely owned by us. But when you build a huge military, you're creating the ready-made method to start wars, okay, and carry out acts, which you wouldn't do if you didn't have the military. And if people were free and had weapons themselves, you know, we wouldn't be able to go into their countries and mess with them. And, you know,
no, I mean, that's the whole, you know, whatever bullshit purpose they want to say, the purpose of having a standing military is so they can go and do whatever the politicians want them to do and achieve those goals. That's all it is. Because, again, as we talked about, you don't need a military to defend any place here. You have plenty of people with guns. You have plenty of people that right away would defend their own neighborhoods. It's not going to happen. Plus, I mean, you have nuclear weapons as well. So you don't need a military here. I think that's pretty obvious. And
not one this big. Well, there's no way.
Well, first of all, most people that would not join the military may join a military if a country was actually attacking their state.
Sure. Yep. More people than are volunteering now.
I don't know that I'd actually join some fucking whatever, but I would be out there, you know, shooting fucking whoever is invading. You know, so.
Well, I mean, look at wars that were, you know, we haven't had a war where we've been attacked in a long, long time. But, you know, World War II, we were, you know, at least you could say we were physically attacked. And they had, you know, they had volunteers, but they also drafted.
Well, it was a military base, people. And it wasn't a state. And basically, from what I understand back then, really all it was a fucking military base.
When did Hawaii become a state?
Not till after that. Not till 50s? I think 1949.
Yeah.
Well, so it was not a state in 39. It was not a state at that point. And all that was attacked was a military base. So I don't know that you consider that an attack. I guess you could say, well, the World Trade Center bombing was an attack, but then, you know, it depends how you want to look at
it. That wasn't a foreign military force.
Right.
So, no matter what you say about it, that was not a formal government.
Yeah, right. Even if you want to say that, okay, yeah, it was a bunch of terrorists that got together and did it, which I don't believe that's what happened. But yeah, it wasn't a foreign military.
Trained by the FBI.
So the U.S. really has never been attacked by any foreign military ever. And supposedly, though, well, there's all these threats, you know, and they invent every fucking threat they can. Well, now it's cyber threats. Now we need to do this. Now it's ISIS. Now it's this. Now it's that. It's especially they love to come up with the very complicated to deal with attacks, you know, because if it's just a country, it's like, oh, we can just go in that country and just drop a bomb and there it is and it's done. They love shit like ISIS because it's like, oh, look, ISIS, you know, have sleeper cells. They can invade us at any time. They can whatever. And
well,
you
they
know,
made it. So,
justify you know, all the. Yeah, they would know.
They love their baby.
They can justify all of these things. But, you know, going back to these wars, and even now, I mean, okay, people that joined after 9/11, I guess I can understand. Vietnam, again, a lot of people were drafted. So I understand the people that just, you know, that really didn't have another option, go to jail or go to war. I don't know. And I know Jimmy Carter pardoned everybody later, but.
Well, they still had to sweat it out. I mean,
for people that, well, like the people that went to Canada, but the people that now are joining the military, I don't know that they have any excuse anymore. I really don't.
They're still brainwashed. Like I said, they're pressured because of a terror. They're in a depression. I mean, what's it like? I mean, how would you? I would hate to be 18 to 25 years old starting out. I mean, even if you go to college, okay, you're going into a depressed, which means shrinking economy for work.
Right.
And the only way to get a job is for somebody to leave their job, you know, through, you know, whatever reason they left it. And there's a true vacation, which means of the job, probably death, or they leave the country, or they just leave the workforce.
Retire.
I mean,
I guess
there's no great reason to join the military right now, except for the fact that you can get a lot of benefits and you can get training. And I know so many relatives that talk about it, and I've talked a number of them out of it.
Yeah, but look what they're, again, that's like saying, okay, you know what, I can join the mafia and make a lot of money. And
they don't, but they don't, they're not told that way. They don't know. So that's where I differ with you, is that when they're 18, they're not that aware. They're relying on the older people. And the older, a lot of older people are saying, yeah, join this and join that and you'll be this. And the service is great for me and it'll straighten me out and da 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 da. You know, and you're admitting when you say that it straightened me out is I was a screw up and I needed someone to babysit me for 4 years. And don't think the military doesn't babysit you into shape, you know. What I tell kids is this, Dave. I say, think about this commitment you're going to make for 4 years where you're locked into a scenario and you have no freedom while you're in there to do what you really want to do. You have very little room to wiggle on. I said you could take 4 years of your time, and if you work hard, you can do much more for yourself in those 4 years than you could by joining the military. And I said use that time as an opportunity to do that. You're free and you can do that, and you can completely out excel what you were going to do in the military. It doesn't matter what you're trying to learn. And I said, if you work hard. And, you know, I've talked people out of doing it, I don't know, temporarily or permanently because of that. And they saw that. And I said, you know, you're going to get put into a situation where you're going to do a lot of stuff that you don't want to do. It doesn't matter if it's, you know, scrubbing potatoes for, you know, kitchen duty or pots and pans, or having to go off into a war zone. You know, I said, I tell them there's no real threat on this country. Nothing real.
And there hasn't been since when or ever.
A real threat to this country? Like an honest to God real threat? Germany, yeah, they were real. But they were created, but an organic threat to this country.
Well, can you even say they were a threat to the United States? And I know, well, if it wasn't for, well, actually, I think that's the other way around, that where people say if it wasn't for the U.S., you know, people be speaking German. But, you know, one of the things that somebody had brought up on a show, too, is the setup of the landmass of the U.S., and how it's not easy. It's not an easy country to attack anyway. You know what I mean? It's not like the easiest. And plus, it's pretty big landmass. And yeah, I mean, besides Canada and Mexico.
It's not easy to go through Canada.
So it's not, you know, the easiest country to attack. And if other countries want to attack the U.S., part of it is their own fucking fault and all of the other shit that they've done with, you know, all these covert operations. You look at Iran and installing, you know, the Shah of Iran and all of these other things. Supposedly Saddam Hussein worked for the CIA, and really
that was not legitimate.
Again, the other thing that happened after World War II was the CIA, which was not supposed to be a permanent organization. It was supposed to be a temporary organization. And, of course, look what it turned into. And I don't know what things were like prior to that. I'm sure they had, and I think they did, they had similar organizations, but not to the extent of, I guess, the CIA. But so, you know, looking at this now, I mean, what is a hero, and what respect do these people in the military deserve, if any? So if you see somebody walking down a street in a military uniform, and I hate that, for one, because a lot of them, you know, you're talking about like people that are going out wearing their military uniform. I understand if there's like a specific reason that they have to have their military uniform on, like maybe they're flying somewhere and it has to be on when they get where they're going or something. I don't know. But what the fuck are you doing?
You know what?
It
wasn't even allowed when I was in.
That you couldn't wear it?
You were not allowed to wear your working uniform. If you were out in town, you had to wear, and you were going to wear a uniform, you had to wear what they call the Charlies, which was the business uniform dress. You couldn't wear your fatigues because they didn't want people, you know, it wasn't, you know,
that's what they wear, though. It is
out in the public in America as the military. Right. And the military
a business uniform thing. But it's like a military business uniform.
That's a combat. See, there's a combat uniform.
Because I know what you're talking about. Yeah, it's not the fatigue. No, I'm not talking about, you know, seeing people wearing like the fatigue combat stuff.
But they do. But they're wearing them in public all the time.
But I'm just even talking about the ones where it's like a suit jacket with a hat, but it's a military uniform. You know they're in the military.
Yeah, well, they're required to wear that sometimes. If they're
going out to a bar, so that's what I'm saying.
They're not supposed to go to bars with those.
It depends where they're at, but it seems like some of them do it on purpose to try to get attention or whatever. But
it's not. I got a tip for you. It's a lousy way to pick up women. Okay.
Some women like men in uniform, I guess. No, that is
that died in World War II. that was, if that even was true back then. I mean, yeah, no, it's not. And when you're in the military and you're in a military town, you know, the civilians are on guard. The daughters are on guard unless they're lunatics.
With all the things that the CIA and the military and military intelligence does, tell me how they are any different than any other fucked up country or any gang or any mafia or any of that. How? Because I don't see it.
How it's better?
How they're any different. Well, I guess that would be how it's better. How are they heroes? How is going into a country, and let's take the last couple conflicts. First of all, you have it, because I remember hearing this story maybe a year ago where they just went into, I forget what country in the Middle East, they just kidnap people in the middle of the night, you know, that they consider criminals. Not to mention, you know, drone bombing people's houses.
Yemen? Is it Yemen?
I think it was Yemen. Going into Iraq. Going into Iran years ago, doing all of these things.
So what stage in the military, to be specific, because there's a huge difference between a kid coming into boot camp and a guy who's on his third tour. A huge difference.
Well, what would gigantic. Be the difference? You're saying that they know better?
No. Well, normally, if you're a normal person and you go into a war zone, okay, there's several different things going to happen. One of them is completely turned off from it and say, you know, this is wrong. Another aspect is you're like, I don't like this. I'm not going to hurry up for this. So you leave. So both instances, you leave. Different reasons, right? And then there are people. All right, when I was in, Beirut got hot, and some veterans were calling it, the action there is hot as it was in Vietnam in places. There was that much activity. And people were reenlisting with the line to say, I want to make sure I can go into Beirut. They were volunteering to go back into Beirut. I knew someone who wanted to go back, and they told him they did a psych eval and said he was too environmentally adapted to return to that theater. And they wouldn't let him go back to that theater.
He wanted to go back to that theater. Well, let's do this. Let's take a break. And when we come back, let's kind of look at, I guess, that whole process because I feel bad. Especially, you know, knowing when I was graduating from high school, I had these motherfuckers calling me all the time. And of course, you know, I was had the attitude of I didn't like the military back then. I'm like, there's no way I'm going to take your fucking orders. You know, I tried to be kind of nice, but get off the phone pretty quick. And I'm like, no, I'm not interested, you know, but they'd call. I don't know how many calls I got from them. And I know how they try to manipulate, you know, kids getting out of high school. And, you know, that there probably is a huge difference between an 17, 18-year-old kid getting out of high school and some of these other people. So when we come back, we can talk a little about that as well. I also want to talk about this whole, again, going back to this celebration and the hero aspect and all of that. So we're going to take a break. When we come back, we will talk all about that. We'll be back with Orlando's Pete Murtha, a veteran after 180 days. And not that I'm laughing at Pete for that. I'm just saying that's kind of fucked up. They can say you're a veteran after 180 days. I don't know how many days you got to play football to be considered a veteran. Or I guess I'd be a veteran in my career by now.
What is it in the NFL? You're a veteran after one season, which is how long?
No, it's not one season.
Yeah, it's one season. You're a rookie year, and then you're a veteran.
You're a rookie, and then you're a mid. I don't know, whatever. We'll have to look at that. So anyway,
we'll compare it.
If you'd like to call in with your angry thoughts, you can call in at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Also, you can check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com and on Spreaker. And we will be right back after this.
When should you shoot a cop? That question, even without an answer, makes most law-abiding taxpayers go into knee-jerk conniptions. The indoctrinated masses all race to see who can be first and loudest to proclaim that it is never okay to forcibly resist law enforcement. In doing so, they also inadvertently demonstrate why so much of human history has been plagued by tyranny and oppression. In an ideal world, cops would do nothing except protect people from thieves and attackers, in which case shooting a cop would never be justified. In the real world, however, far more injustice, violence, torture, theft, and outright murder has been committed in the name of law enforcement than has been committed in spite of it. To get a little perspective, try watching a documentary or two about some of the atrocities committed by the regimes of Stalin or Lenin or Chairman Mao, or Hitler, or Pol Pot, or any number of other tyrants in history. Pause the film when the jackboots are just about to herd innocent people into the cattle cars, or just about to gun them down as they stand on the edge of a ditch, and then ask yourself the question, when should you shoot a cop? Keep in mind, the evils of those regimes were committed in the name of law. And as much as the statement may make people cringe, the history of the human race would have been a lot less gruesome if there had been a lot more cop killers around to deal with the state mercenaries of those regimes. Now, people don't mind when you point out the tyranny that has happened in other countries, but most have a hard time viewing their own country, their own government, and their own law enforcers in any sort of objective way. Having been trained to feel a blind loyalty to the ruling class of the particular piece of dirt they live on, also known as patriotism, and having been trained to believe that obedience is a virtue, the idea of forcibly resisting law enforcement is simply unthinkable to many. Literally, they can't even think about it. And humanity has suffered horribly because of it. It is a testament to the effectiveness of authoritarian indoctrination that literally billions of people throughout history have begged and screamed and cried in the face of authoritarian injustice and oppression, but only a tiny fraction have ever actually lifted a finger to try to stop it. Even when people can recognize tyranny and oppression, they still usually talk about working within the system, the same system that's responsible for the tyranny and the oppression. People want to believe that the system will, sooner or later, provide justice. The last thing they want to consider is that they should illegally resist, that if they want to achieve justice, they must become criminals and terrorists, which is what anyone who resists legal injustice is automatically labeled. But history shows all too well that those who fight for freedom and justice almost always do so illegally, i.e., without the permission of the ruling class. If politicians think that they have the right to impose any law they want, and cops have the attitude that as long as it's called law, they will enforce it, what is there to prevent complete tyranny? Not the consciences of the lawmakers or their hired thugs, obviously, and not any election or petition to the politicians. When tyrants define what counts as law, then by definition, it is up to the lawbreakers to combat tyranny. Pick any example of abuse of power, whether it's the fascist so-called war on drugs, the police thuggery that has become so common, the random stops and searches now routinely carried out in the name of security, such as at airports, border checkpoints that aren't even at the border, sobriety checkpoints, and so on, or any other example. Now ask yourself the uncomfortable question. If it's wrong for cops to do these things, doesn't that imply that the people have a right to resist such actions? And of course, state mercenaries don't take kindly to being resisted, even non-violently. If you question their right to detain you, interrogate you, search you, invade your home, and so on, you are very likely to be tasered, physically assaulted, kidnapped, put in a cage, or shot. If a cop decides to treat you like livestock, whether he does it legally or not, you will usually have only two options: submit or kill the cop. You can't resist a cop just a little and get away with it. He will always call in more of his fellow gang members until you are subdued or dead. Basic logic dictates that you either have an obligation to let law enforcers have their way with you, or you have the right to stop them from doing so, which will almost always require killing them. Politely asking fascists to not be fascists has a very poor track record throughout history. Consider the recent Indiana Supreme Court ruling, which declared that if a cop tries to illegally enter your home, it's against the law for you to do anything to stop him. Aside from the patent absurdity of it, since it amounts to giving thugs with badges permission to break the law and makes it a crime for you to defend yourself against a criminal if he has a badge, consider the logical ramifications of that attitude. There were once some words written on a piece of parchment, those words now known as the Fourth Amendment, that said that you have the right to be free from unreasonable searches and seizures at the hands of government agents. In Indiana today, what could that possibly mean? The message from the ruling class is quite clear and utterly insane. It amounts to this: we don't have the right to invade your home without probable cause, but if we do, you have no right to stop us, and we have the right to arrest you if you try. Why not apply that to the rest of the Bill of Rights while we're at it? You have the right to say what you want, but if we use violence to shut you up, you have to let us. I can personally attest to the fact that that is the attitude of the U.S. so-called Department of Justice. Or maybe, you have the right to have guns, but if we try to forcibly and illegally disarm you and you resist, we have the right to kill you. Ask Randy Weaver or the Branch Davidians about that one. You have the right to not testify against yourself, but when we coerce you into confessing and call it a plea agreement, you can't do a thing about it. What good is a right? What does the term right even mean if you have an obligation to allow jackboots to violate your so-called rights? It makes the term absolutely meaningless. To be blunt, if you have the right to do A, It means that if someone tries to stop you from doing A, even if he has a badge and a politician's scribble, sometimes called law, on his side, you have the right to use whatever amount of force is necessary to resist that person. That's what it means to have an unalienable right. If you have the unalienable right to speak your mind, a la the First Amendment, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to shut you up. If you have the unalienable right to be armed, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to disarm you. If you have the right to not be subjected to unreasonable searches and seizures, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to inflict those upon you. Those who are proud to be law-abiding don't like to hear this and don't like to think about this, but what's the alternative? If you do not have the right to forcibly resist so-called legal injustice, that logically implies that you have an obligation to allow government agents to do absolutely anything they want to you, your home, your family, your neighbors, and so on. Really, there are only two choices. You are a slave, the property of the politicians, without any rights at all, or you have the right to violently resist government attempts to oppress you. There can be no other option. Of course, on a practical level, openly resisting the gang called government is usually very hazardous to one's health. But there's a big difference between obeying for the sake of self-preservation, which is often necessary and rational, and feeling a moral obligation to go along with whatever the ruling class wants to do to you, which is pathetic and insane. Most of the incomprehensible atrocities that have occurred throughout history were due in large part to the fact that most people answer never to the question of when should you shoot a cop. The correct answer is, when evil is legal, become a criminal. When oppression is enacted as law, become a lawbreaker. And when those violently victimizing the innocent have badges, become a cop killer. So the next time you hear of a police officer being killed in the line of duty, take a moment to consider the very real possibility that maybe in that case, the law enforcer was the bad guy and the cop killer was the good guy. As it happens, that has been the case more often than not throughout human history.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne.
(702-470-7664) is the number to call in if you have been offended and want to voice your opinion, or if you have not been offended but just want to voice your opinion. You can also Skype into the show as well, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We've been talking all about Memorial Day, as well as how it relates to the military, and beginning and getting into various discussions regarding the military as well. Just another note, that clip that I had played during the break was from Larkin Rose, who, if you are not familiar with Larkin Rose, please check out his channel on YouTube. I think he makes a great bunch of points, which I tend to agree with a lot of things that he says, and he's a lot better at articulating them than I am. And it's kind of weird because it wasn't like I heard Larkin Rose and I was like, oh yeah, I think those things. It was more, I had pretty much thought those things, but heard Larkin Rose and heard the way that he was able to articulate them and thought, of course, that he did it so much better. So definitely check him out. But getting back to the military, you know, I was thinking about a couple things during the break. I mean, first of all, when we think about being protected, quote unquote, from protecting our freedom, right? So first of all, what is freedom? And I would say that we currently do not have freedom, nor have probably any human beings throughout history had freedom. I don't know what was going on with cavemen, but I doubt women had freedom during those days. Well, I guess if you watch the cartoons where they hit the women over the head with the, you know, the cave, whatever those things, what are those things called? The, they look like baseball bats, but they're made out of,
Dave, come on. A club.
Club, right. So they hit them in the... Right, yeah. They clubbed them over the head. I should know that. Well, I don't mean I should know that because I club women over the head. I just mean I should know that because that's what they call it. So I don't think we've ever had freedom. But if you want to define freedom, how does that have anything to do with the military? Period. Now, again, if you had countries or terrorists or pirates or whatever, you know, coming and attacking certain states or any sort of attacks, and the military somehow were the ones who fought them off, which I doubt it would even get to that point because the people of those areas, I think, would take care of that themselves. But not to mention, and I mean, obviously this is something I don't approve of neither. What about all the fucking police there are? The police that are basically like the military now. So how do you justify, well, we need a foreign military to go out and attack other countries, but we need a military within the U.S. too, to attack the people here, I guess. I mean, the whole concept of all of this shit is ridiculous. It makes no sense. And it's all about, you know, specific agendas, money, power, and control.
I guess you want me to step in, Dave, and make a comment
here. Well, if you don't have any thoughts, you know.
Well, I was actually listening to what you were saying, and it was they're good points. I mean, I don't think we need, you know, we talked about this earlier about a big defense. Look at how it's geared. Are we geared more for defense or offense? And I think you would say, well,
and that's a great, you could argue that's a great point.
But we're geared for offense.
Yeah.
We're geared to go after countries and go into them.
Exactly. And that is a great point. It is totally set up for offense, to attack other countries. And that's what I was saying. That's the purpose of a standing army, because why have a standing army in the first place? Because you can go out there and whatever agenda you may have, you can execute that with these troops that you've somehow been able to condition to think that, oh, they're protecting freedom. It makes no fucking sense. How does, look at everything that happened in Iraq. How did any of that protect anybody here's freedom at all? How? If anything, you could say that, well, it made it more dangerous because it might have angered some Iraqis that maybe, you know, might do something, you know, not all that serious, but, you know, shoot somebody or get a bomb or something, right? So
that's their point, though, isn't it? That we're in danger of being attacked by angry people.
Well, I was saying more
so on make them angrier.
Well, what I was saying is, yeah, on a much lower level, just like any, you know, crazy person would go out and just shoot somebody. So and I don't think the chances of that are even too high. But my point being that if it was going to do anything, you know, all it's going to do is make people angry. It's not protecting. How can somebody literally sit there? And I know the Bush thing was, well, we're going to fight them over there so we don't have to fight them over here. But there was no having to fight them over here.
Yeah. How's that working? Now we're doing giant military drills so we can fight them over here.
And then you have the president going after guns as much as he has, but then saying how dangerous, you know, terrorism is. Oh, well, you know, we got all these terrorists, dangerous. We got to bring in the military. We got to fight these ISILs. But we got to take all your guns away in the process. Like, how does that make any sense?
Well, it's a ploy, right? I mean, have you heard the angle they're doing now? I mean, if you're serving in the military, look at what they're saying, that they need to remove our rights to make us safer.
And that was, what specifically are you referring to there?
It's a culmination of articles that have been going on the last couple of weeks. I mean, they've been talking about that in several, I mean, I read it on Drudge and where else, I don't remember specifically, but they're talking about it. I think they even brought it up on TV.
Wait, they're talking. Go ahead.
They need. Oh, with the NSA oversight, is that they need to violate our rights to keep.
Oh,
us
right,
safe.
right, to keep the section.
And
of
they literally talk about suspending some of our rights so they could do that. Because if you don't allow these open, wide open wiretapping, right, you won't find the terrorists.
What about the fact that some people, and I would say this as well, I'd rather be dead than not be free. So I'm willing to take the risk. I don't need you fucking NSA or police or whatever. You know, I have guns too. I can take care of myself. If some terrorist wants to try to kill me or blow up my car, well, I have a garage now, so at least it'd be a little harder, then fine. And why would some fucking terrorist target me anyway? I guess if you're at a mall, there's like the mass things I guess they're worried about, like a mall or a movie theater or whatever. You know, it's not worth it. That's the whole thing, that like that. You know, quote,
you know,
from Ben Franklin.
How many
Franklin.
People talk about America, the home of the brave, and we're afraid of, you know, maybe someone going off in a mall with a
pretty
brave. Oh,
well, there was a
the
recent
whole country is going to give up their rights because they're afraid of this, and then we're the home of the brave.
There was a recent report that nothing the FBI has done has stopped anything or prevented anything, and there's been reports about other agencies as well. So it's this same thing that keeps repeating over and over again, right? Not only do you have what the government does totally violate your rights, but it doesn't even accomplish what they try to accomplish. So say like the drug war. No matter what, even if somehow their bullshit drug war reduced the amount of people doing drugs, I would still say it's bullshit because you have the right to put what you want in your body. But not only do you have the right to put what you want in your body, but the evidence supports that what they're doing does not help at all. It makes it worse.
Yeah, I was going to say, you can't point to hypothetical situations that have never been proven true in any aspect, right? Where you're saying, even if it did reduce them, it never does. As soon as you put a prohibition on something, all it does is make it push it more demand.
Yeah, you can look at anything. Now you look at terrorism. You look at whatever.
You could ban bobbleheads, and they will become so valuable, and there'll be a giant black market on bobbleheads, and there'll be police raids, and it'll be a national crisis. It doesn't matter what you ban, you know.
But one
of the ban trading cards.
So one of the things that I've been talking about, or at least I talked a lot about last week, and I've been thinking a lot about is, what now? So, you know, okay, I do a show. I know at least on Spreaker, because I don't know on the website yet, because I still haven't set up where I can track how many listens I get, and I got to do a bunch of stuff that I'm behind on. But, you know, whatever. Maybe to each show, I'll get at least like 25 people, 30 people, if I count probably the Spreaker stuff. Not to speak of the website. Maybe if I'm lucky, I'll get 50 listens or something, which is, that's not a lot at all. And a lot of them are probably people that already have the exact same ideas anyway. But, you know, that's good. I mean, for me, that's a huge thing. The fact that I can reach that many people, which isn't a lot of people, but for me, like, who the fuck am I? And I can actually have people listen to me broadcasting on the internet. I mean, that's a big thing for me. You know, it's like, again, who the fuck am I? But so whatever. So there's a bunch of other people doing the same stuff, which is great. There's a lot of independent media out there. So, okay, hopefully, you know, collectively we're reaching a lot of people through whoever's show, and they're thinking more about these things and realizing what's going on. And where do we go? So most people, as I mentioned before, realize that the government, for the most part, is not run by the elected officials. It's run by, you know, whether you think it's corporations or lobbyists or, you know, some cabal or whatever, or a combination. You know, point being that for the most part, you're not going to get much done if you're trying to lobby politicians. You know, you might get some small stuff done on local levels and shit like that, but you're not going to make the huge changes that we'd like to see, you know, regarding freedom. So what, at this point, I mean, what do you do? You know, for me, again, I can keep doing this show all the time and hopefully reaching people and, you know, whatever. But it's like, I said this analogy last week, you know, it's like maybe you can change some small things, and it's like a big dam where for every one a hole you plug, you get a million more. I mean, this is a huge thing. This is every day, you know, more and more things are happening. And, you know, to be able to even follow all of it is impossible. You'd have to have a staff of hundreds of people that are, you know, on top of all of this shit. And unfortunately, we're not in positions, you know, most of the people that are in independent media or doing radio shows or TV shows or whatever, where they can even dedicate, you know, they can do full time. You know, luckily there are shows like Free Talk Live, but I mean, that's one in a million. There's not a lot of these liberty oriented shows that are out there. And part of it, I think, is because I think it is, they are blacklisted to a certain extent. The other part of it is, I think, when you're you have so many other things you have to do and you can't dedicate that time to, you know, get better, that I don't think, and I've talked about this before, myself included, that a lot of the liberty shows are on the same level, that they're good enough to compete, not because of the content, but just, you know, like a professional show. And when I say professional, not to confuse people, I don't mean like, yes, this is Ted Koppel for ABC News and we're talking, you know what I mean? But it's, you know, you're not making mistakes and hearing bangs in the background and cat noises and whatever. So, and you're not getting silence and all of these things. But where, and this is the question I keep asking, it's like, how do you stop this stuff?
Well, I have a number of thoughts on that, because I think about that often. And the best way to combat your loss of liberty is to exercise it. And that sounds too obscure, but I'll give you an example. I go to a farmer's market to shop, okay? So I start diverting my dollars from processed food, you know, by large manufacturers into small cottage businesses. That is amazing. It wouldn't take fraction of the public to make a change.
Cottage cheese from the cottage business?
Yeah, they call them cottages because they're governed under cottage laws. So they can't make certain claims because of this. They can't talk about, like, it's funny. I mean, a corporation advertising something on TV can say our product will enhance your social life and make all kinds of claims, right? And they're allowed to do it under, you know, laws that govern marketing, because it doesn't matter that they're making, like, if they would say we're the best soap, okay, they can go ahead and do that. Or if they can say this will control your psoriasis. But the cottage industries can't do things like name ingredients and tell you what benefit they're going to produce for you. Like, at least in the state of Florida, because that's, you know, the vendors will say, we're not allowed to tell, we can tell you what's in there, but we're not allowed to tell you anything about it.
Like, yeah, like, if you take this, your sexual organs will grow by 5 inches.
Yeah, or that, you know, this is healthy for your heart. You know, they're not allowed to do that. They can tell you what's in it, but they can't tell you what it does for you, you know, because they're not qualified. But supporting these small businesses is actually does many, many, many things to fight the system. Okay. And, you know, cash business is something that kind of comes, it drops below the radar of government, right? They can't monitor you when you're not using a credit card and you're not, you know, transacting it through banks and checks and things like that.
Well, that's why.
And they're trying to wipe cash out.
Yeah, and we talked about that last week with Ken Shorjan of the Daily Economist, where that's what they're trying to do is go to a cashless system.
Yeah, they're really pushing for that because they want to know what the hell everybody's doing and control everything. So the other thing you can do is start a cottage business. Start doing something that makes money. And you're like, well, that's challenging. Well, yeah, too bad. You can't watch TV every day of the week, every night when you do that. You have to actually read a book, study, learn things. And you might even find it's fun or interesting, actually. But when you do that, okay, you start taking control of your own economy. And it changes society is. Because this disables the corporations and the big lobbyists from having access to money that they would have through you, okay? And then when you start doing these things, you start seeing what the government does to interfere with your life, okay? Like how they get in the way for no real reason, okay, no good reason of interfering with your life through licensure and things like that, you know, regulations, statutes, you know, But you know, that is a direct way of fighting this. The other thing is, don't buy crap. You know, don't eat at places that have, you know, food that is unhealthy for you, because that puts you, it puts money in their pockets. It puts you to the doctors to go on prescription drugs that never help you, but just prolong your disease so you live longer, sicker.
Well, it depends which ones you're getting, actually.
Which one? What?
Prescription drugs.
It's rare that they actually cure something.
Oh no, I was talking about the ones. If you get the ones that make you feel better.
Oh, like marijuana.
Make you feel happy or something.
Yeah. Right. So you know, live healthy. You know, exercise. Take care of yourself. If you're healthy, you know, you won't complain about the healthcare system, unless you have an accident or there's something congenital wrong with you. And you'll have more
congenital
time and
herpes?
More money to help people around you, which just makes the liberty thing go even farther. Because then you'll stop listening to you know, when you start putting a stake in the ground or having some skin in the game, then you'll be more willing to, you know, think of things differently. But as long as you go along with the whole process, the whole system, and don't push back on it and say, you know, this is it, you wind up watching, you know, staged sporting events that aren't real, okay, and cheering for teams that, you know, could care less about you, you know, athletes, owners, things like
that. Well, see, a lot of stuff like that I don't care about as much. I did get season tickets to UNLV again, but I don't have a problem supporting a college, although I disagree with a lot of the things that they do. But I don't have a problem, you know, supporting a college. I'm not going to give my money to a pro team. And pretty much outside of football, I don't really watch any other sports if boxing's on, like, HBO or something.
Well, I'll take my son to a Magic game once a year, you know. I don't do that. Fine. But, you know, I don't sit around and, you know, try to generate revenue for these guys.
Right, but you know, I think...
I don't pay $165 for a Giants jersey.
I think what's hard, and this is the government that has done this, is even when you... And I think I was talking about this last week when Ellen was on. And when you try to stop shopping at, like, you know, like I pretty much won't shop at Walmart, that... There's not that many small businesses anymore because the government has helped them to basically eliminate them. Then at the same time, you know, almost everything's corporate, so it's hard not to work in a corporate world if you want to make any money. And that is definitely a challenge as well. I would like to at some point, and no matter what, it's going to happen at some point where, you know, start my own business and hopefully something liberty-oriented and hopefully even something related to media, you know. But it's not as easy to do to generate the money.
No. The game is rigged against you. But if people – if more people – you know, suppose people grew just $1 of food themselves a week. Okay, there's a lot of people. Okay, that's a lot of money taken out of the economy from these corporations. Okay, and you know, you see what's happening with McDonald's, right? I mean, they're disintegrating right in front of everybody's eyes.
Well, I just heard an announcement today. Taco Bell was one of them. I forget what the other one was, that they're not going to use any artificial stuff in their food anymore. So that's actually been a huge thing, because even Carl's Jr.'s now, I don't know if they have that in Orlando, they haven't, their grass-fed burger. So a lot of that stuff that people have been out there and protesting against companies like Monsanto, and we actually did a show last week on GMOs, that it is making a difference. I'm not saying that things don't make differences, but what I'm saying is the government is just gone so far, you know, even to the point where there's things that the average person doesn't know about. And then even in the informed people like us might not even know about, because it's just kept secret, kept hidden. And you get to a point where, you know, it's like, is it even going to make a difference? The other thing that a lot of people are starting to do, and I think the most successful is in New Hampshire, but is starting these liberty communities. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, those are direct action things, and they have I'll skip to the end with those. I believe what's going to happen to those, as long as the government doesn't come down and really like crush them, and that would be interesting, right? Trying to go into a town full of libertarians and force them to do something, that would be unique. I think those towns are going to generate so much economy that people will be into that town, or towns will wake up and emulate those models. And I think in 20, 30, 40, 50 years, those cities are going to be so far ahead of the game because they're liberty orientated. Okay. And so I think they're awesome because it's a trickle effect. Okay. It's you know, when you do something that involves freedom, it magnifies the outcome. Because oppression destroys all kinds of things.
I don't know if we lost you there. I saw your camera kind of freeze up, so I don't know
when
if
there's a... When did they cut out my mic?
Ah, there we go. Now you're back.
All right. Okay. So what part did I cut out at?
I'm not sure. I know you were talking about the Liberty communities and those being, you know, contagious in a sense that...
They will be, the more They'll be very contagious. They will attract so much economy. They will be so fruitful because people are free. And my point where I wasn't able to express it was that when you are competing against oppression, you know, free society versus oppression, you're talking about this is actually just, you know, completely valid. You have a place that can do what it needs to do freely to excel, and then you have a place that is actively oppressed, okay, where you're not free to do what you think you can do to make things better. The other system is going to crumble, and they always do, okay? And it's not even going to be close, the difference in progress, okay? Because one's sliding backwards, the other one is accelerating forward because of the freedom. And you can, like you talked about, you know, with companies going to grass-fed beef, the thing that you know, that relates right back to what I said. That's healthier food for people. People will be healthier. They'll have stronger bodies and stronger minds. And it's going to destroy companies like Monsanto. It's going to destroy the commercial. How can a commercial farm who produces corn make any money when someone's feeding their beef off of grass? Do you see the example there? If you're producing corn to feed the cattle and nobody wants to eat that cattle because it's been poisoned by GMO corn, how the hell can you grow that corn? You're done. You're going to switch to grass. You're going to grow grass and you're going to feed beef with grass. It annihilates that whole industry of GMO crap. And now people aren't consuming that. They're eating grass. Now, maybe Monsanto has a GMO grass that screws you up just like cattle, but people will figure that out. They'll trace it back and they go, aha, don't eat this. And what it'll do, it'll force people to a point where they won't go out to buy a hamburger. They'll go out to their local farmer who grows grass that isn't GMO grass, and they buy that beef. And it'll just completely consume these commercial, you know, aggregate, you know, industries. The biggest industries we have to fight is the military industrial complex, okay? And we can talk about that last. The next one is food, okay? You have to go after food. And that, in turn, will annihilate the whole insurance company, pharmaceutical company frauds. Those other two are so lethal to us. It's not even funny. But they're enabled by the food chain.
Well, I think legalizing drugs is a huge thing too, because it gets rid of the pharmaceutical companies for the most part. Although they can still produce them, but that just does so many things.
We have to get rid of the FDA. It's useless. It doesn't save any lives. It doesn't protect anybody. And it propagates things that are just
right. But how many government agencies have you seen go away that have been created in your lifetime?
Well, this would be an awesome first, because you know, when you look at what the FDA, the drugs it approves that they have to pull off the shelves because they're so harmful to people, it's not even funny that they oversaw for your protection and they had to pull them.
Well, then you have the other side of it too, where I don't know if you saw the movie with Matthew McConaughey, Dallas Buyers Club, where
it's on my watch list.
They wouldn't. There were all these experimental AIDS drugs, and you know he had to go all over the world to get them into the country. And the only way he was able to, he somehow got around it by selling memberships, and then from the memberships, he was able to give the drugs to people. And it was based on a true story. I don't know how much of it was true and how much of it was not, but it just showed how fucked up the FDA was, that people were actually living longer with AIDS than they would have because the FDA didn't approve this fucking drug. So, you know, even if they wanted to, and again, I don't think they should exist neither, but you know, even if they wanted to do something that says we haven't tested this, we don't know, whatever, you take this at your own risk, which is pretty much what it is anyway. I mean, how many people fucking end up suing pharmaceutical companies and winning? I guess it happens, but not that often. But I want to get back to, because we don't have that much time left, but before the break, we had mentioned this, I guess, kind of cycle that starts when you graduate high school, where you have people that their job is to recruit for the military. And I was at a bar one night, and I actually had hit on this girl and looked really stupid. This was, of course, before I was with my fiance, but it was like 5 years ago or something. I don't know. Anyway, but I was sitting at the bar and I was talking to this guy who told me that, you know, he was in the military and he was going to be a military recruiter now, you know, and I remembered those fucking guys that would call me, you know, of course they get the phone list from the school. I mean, how fucked up is that, right? That they get your phone numbers. It's probably a lot harder now with cell phones and shit. But back then, you know, before cell phones, and they get my parents' number and, you know, they'd call me all the time, probably got like 5 or 6 calls from different people. And, you know, of course, my attitude, as I had said, was, you know, fuck you, really, is what I wanted to say. But, you know, there was no chance of me joining. But they even went into the, you know, oh, well, what do you want to do career-wise? You know, because you can do that in the military. You know, they talk about all the things that you can do in the military. But then you get money for college, too, and, you know, all of this shit.
Well, that's the pitch, you know, to get kids in. But it's they have a lot of resources, but I don't know how popular recruiting is going lately. I you know, they have a lot of the reenlistment rate was really high for a long time, but you know, they're kind of weeding out. I mean, you can only kill a generation of people for so long before that starts to peter out.
Well, I think probably what happened was after 9/11, they were able to totally exploit that. I mean, you had people just enlisting because they had the attitude of, oh, we're going to get the people that did this. They did this to our country, and we need to go and get them. And if you think about that,
it was a very legitimate argument.
The rationale is kind of fucked up, because what does, first of all, and especially when you're talking about a country as big as the United States, where you could fit, you know, like all of Europe and, you know, probably most of Asia except for China and Russia. I mean, it's pretty big land-wise. And you think about all of these people in these other countries that are killed all the time for, you know, ridiculous reasons or, you know, terrorist acts or whatever. And for people to look at that, and I guess I understand more people that were in New York or actually had relatives or friends that were in the building. I guess that would make more sense. But the for people that didn't, that it's, oh, they attacked our country. This is our, so we have to go and get those people back. Even though, I mean, really, who are you getting back? All the people that were there are dead, supposedly, you know.
Well, you know, they're protecting their country. It wasn't a revenge thing. It was them reacting to an attack and saying, we're not going to take this. We're America. We're free. You can't take our freedom, taking our lives, taking our freedom.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that's a total emotional argument.
Right.
It's not a rational conclusion. It's really just totally based on emotion. And of course, the U.S. government
trust.
Exploited that.
Yeah. So, I mean, but look what's happened to the government now? How many people, I mean, what other approval rate? Does Congress have any kind of an approval rating?
The last I heard it was like 8%. It was pretty low.
Right. So,
but it's all for different reasons. It's not like, you know, all libertarians or something. It's, no, you know, all kinds of people. Maybe they feel they're not doing enough. Maybe they feel, you know, they're doing too much. I mean, for whatever reason, yeah.
But they don't trust them.
No. Right. Well, I don't know what approval rating really means. I don't know that it necessarily means trust, although I don't think people trust them neither. I think the approval rating means, you know, the job that they feel that they're doing.
Yeah, but if someone does a bad job for an extended period, okay, you're not pro them anymore because you don't believe that they can do the job you need them to do. But they tell you that. They go, oh, we're going to do this. And so you fall out of trust with them. You're like, you're saying one thing. The complete opposite is happening. We're not safer. Our economy's tanking. You're lying about it. We know that. They've totally lost their initiative. And I'll tell you what, if another 9/11 event happens, I don't think you're going to get everybody signing up for the first reaction that government says, you know, well, this is what happened and this is what we're going to have to do.
I hope not.
I bet you have a lot more pushback.
Well, I don't think that the Boston bombing had the effect that they thought it would, because I totally and I followed that very closely, and I totally think that that was a, you know, CIA or some government agency event, in that they, you know, the kid who they sentenced to death had nothing to do with it. Now, I think maybe the older brother might have been working for the CIA, but working for them, you know, to give them information and stuff like that. But I don't think it had the effect that they thought it would have.
I don't know. I mean, I don't.
I think on people in Boston, it did, because they're that's a whole nother issue. But it didn't seem like, you know, and I don't know, maybe because I followed it a lot more closely, or, you know, my thinking was a little different, you know, based on that. But it didn't seem to me to maybe have the same effect. And I felt like the whole thing was like just, you know, using their old tactics and just replaying them again. Like it felt very sloppy, the way they conducted it. To me, it was just so obvious that, you know, it was government that was involved in it, because they still never showed, and this is the most fucked up part. I mean, there's plenty of fucked up parts. There was even some government documents that were released, but they, you know, blacked out a bunch of stuff. But the fact that they said that they saw the younger kid drop the, you know, backpack, even though the backpack he had was a different color than the one that exploded. They said, well, he had a backpack inside a backpack, because we know all people do that, and that there's video of him putting it down and dropping the backpack. No one's ever seen that video. Not even the governor of Massachusetts at the time. You know, he said, well, the FBI told me. And they asked him, and he said that he didn't see the video. And with all the video that they showed, they had all this video of them that they showed, they didn't show that, because it doesn't exist. And it's not that alone. I'm not basing my conclusion off of that alone. I mean, that was a case that I had, you know, looked at very closely. And actually, when it happened, the day before it happened, I think the next day I had to fly to Orlando. But I was up, you know, with the TV on all night. You know, I can't sleep that well when I'm not home, or when I travel, especially, you know, where I'm 3 hours ahead. And, you know, I followed that closely, and all the lies that they even, you know, changed in interviews. And they had the police chief, you know, saying, oh, yeah, they had like three guns. They had a long gun and whatever. And they only recovered one handgun. There was just so much shit. But my point being that, you know, hopefully you're right that it wouldn't have the same effect. What happened in Boston was a lot smaller. I think only 3 people died, but there were like 200 and something that were injured, and it was pretty graphic where you had people with their legs blown off.
Well, you know, the things that happen after these events is some of the victims genuinely research the event, just like 9/11, where there's there are survivor families who have genuinely researched the event, and, you know, they're pushing back, and they won't take money from the government, and they want answers because they don't want to sign an agreement that says we'll never, you know, seek any damages, or this will be the end of this matter.
Right.
So, you know,
non-disclosure agreements.
Yeah, you'll eventually get people from the Boston bombing who will be able to read material from, you know, testifying about this on their own behalf, and you know, it's. There are a lot of New Yorkers that know this was complete crap, you know, and, you know, there's a huge problem. Like the what was it, the firefighters who were involved in 9/11, they're the first responders that were on the scene. They wouldn't allow them, from what I understand, at the anniversary memorial, because these guys got their eyes wide open what went on. You know, they heard giant booming explosions coming out of the bottom of the building. You know, building. Okay.
Well, you had the same type thing at the Oklahoma City bombing as well. And
yeah, right. So, and they were able to muffle that, but you know, they show their hand when they do this stuff. They, you know, it's not for free. You get to see how they operate and what they do and how they're going to do it. And, you know, and more people can learn about that and get ready for these responses. But it's hard. I got people who are all that live in Boston who are like all about, you know, yeah, we got to search the houses and find the terrorist.
Yeah, no, yeah. I had, you know, some quotes that I had posted, you know, online from, you know, I used to live in Boston, so I know a lot of people there. And, you know, they were angry and it all basing stuff on emotion. And even I think it was even a relative of yours that got pretty angry about something I had posted. So it's hard to say, you know, what's going to happen and, you know, how far they have to go to actually get the reactions that they want, and who knows. And I just, you know, and maybe I'm pessimistic, but just looking at all the information and seeing the patterns and how people are just so easily brainwashed, or I don't even know that brainwashed is the word, but blinded by emotion, or it's hard for them to really see the reality. So, I mean, on one side of it, and I've said this before, that I think you have an increasing number of people that are seeing a lot of this stuff and support freedom and see what's going on. But I think on the other side, you also have an increasing number of people that are just ignorant and dumbed down. And, you know, they only need a certain percentage of people to run things. And I think that's kind of what they're, you know, preying on at this point.
Well, you know, my fear is they do something so massive that is so devastating that it's too big a shock for people to think rationally. You know, something that I want to talk about is, you know, I believe completely that the only way out of this is the first thing is people have to start loving each other. And, you know, the other one is to, you know, be truthful, to be honest, you know, but that leads up to love. And I'm going to be more patient with people about their beliefs, because over time, I've had people who at first told me this is ridiculous to, they now say, well, even if it was true, and there may be truth to that, you know, what can you do about it? So I don't take that as more denial. I take that as a positive, because if they're now open to the concept that things like 9/11, Oklahoma City, you know, this war on terror are fake, okay, they're going to start believing, okay, that this isn't real, and that maybe I should look at this more carefully. I'm going to take it that way, because when you challenge people when they're emotional, it's really an emotional response from ourselves.
The
you're,
problem
you're upset they don't understand, and you need to let them go through this process and then approach it, because right, it's terrifying and they're conditioned.
One of the problems that I have is that, to me, still doesn't come to the solution. And you have people, and I mention Alex Jones all the time, where, you know, he talks about all these things that the government is doing and then talks about, well, we just get the right people in and go back to the Constitution. And maybe that's why I'm so pessimistic, because I don't see people, I see them so far off of where things should really be. Even if they're like, well, yeah, the government does some corrupt things and we need to get rid of some things and stuff like that. You know, I don't see people getting to a point where they say, well, we need to totally get rid of government police and the power that they have, or people, you know, even starting to think about getting rid of aspects of government, the majority, I mean, really all of it in the end, but even to think about some of it. So, you know, just because a lot of what that does, the conspiracy part of it, or, you know, not even saying it's a conspiracy, but learning that the government, you know, is involved in this and that, for a lot of people, it doesn't really change their opinion of government in that way. It makes them think that we have a problem with government. We need to get these corrupt people out, and we need to go back to the Constitution, as opposed to the problem is government. The problem is not, you know, the people, or because these things are over and over again, you know, through years and years. And obviously, well, if the Constitution worked, then how did it get to where it's at now? So, but I think the most important thing that I really think now, and I guess this kind of relates to the military in a sense, because if people, you know, brought their kids up to really see what the military is, it would stop a lot of them from joining it. But I honestly think peaceful parenting and the getting rid of discipline and the way people discipline kids now. And I'm not saying, you know, I know people hearing that right away is like, that's crazy. You have to discipline your kids and whatever. But I'm talking about when you take enough time and talk to your kids and help guide their decisions and have that trusting relationship with them, and you let them do what they want to do, but you don't just do it like, oh, just go do whatever and bye. No, you have to be probably more involved than you would be. But instead of bringing up kids to be slaves and pass them over to the government, which is essentially what's happening with the majority of people, they're bringing their kids up to be, you know, the parents are, they're supposed to be obedient to their parents. You know, if their parents tell them something, it doesn't matter if it makes sense or not. You do what I tell you. You live in my house. You know, all of this shit that everyone's heard from their parents and a lot of people repeat to their kids. And then they just get handed over to the government. Now the government's their parents. And it takes away a lot of that freedom and free thinking and probably even that wanting to be free. I mean, if you go 18 years with, you know, wanting to be free for so long and then get to that point, it's, you know, I don't know. I mean, obviously it doesn't happen to everybody, but I think that if people are raising free people, that I think that would totally change the world, to be honest.
And I completely agree with you, Dave.
And even something with the military, and I just we got 10 minutes left. I just want to make sure we kind of, you know, wrap that up. But where we were talking about, you know, okay, so they get the kids in, they're naive. Okay, I can totally understand that, and I feel like they're manipulated and whatever. But then you were talking about getting to different stages.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You know, there are always people who are genuinely motivated about safeguarding you. They have that nurturing, protective nature to them, right? So, and those people do heroic things, and they're unselfish. But there's another cut in there that, like the action, I really don't know if there's anything you can do in the private sector as easily that generates the kind of thrill seeking that the military provides, okay? Because the military will push you right to the point where you die doing stuff, okay? They do it every day. People die doing things in the military that, or they come really close to dying, and they like that adrenaline. You know, they like being part of this unit because, you know, it gives them a sense of belonging and achievement.
Maybe they can be movie stuntmen.
You know, when you're jumping out of an aircraft, you know, at 5,000 feet, or you know, in a covert operation, or these halo jumpers who go, I don't know, God, how far they jump from, you know, and you're doing stuff that you just, I mean, if you try to do that privately, first of all, it's probably outlawed. I don't know if you can go up at a 20,000 feet and jump out of an airplane legally, but you know, they're just, you don't have access to that kind of equipment. You can't drive a tank, okay, down the street and shoot at things every day, okay? And if you like shooting guns, wait till you get in a tank and let one rip, you know?
Yeah, but those are the people that are probably the most dangerous that you don't want in the fucking military, because they're going to be out murdering people.
Well, they're also coming out and becoming cops, you know? So that's a big problem.
Worse. Yeah, so...
And there used to be... You know what? There used to be police departments that would not hire military. They just flat out would not do it. You know, especially MPs. They wouldn't hire military police because these guys were so over-the-top aggressive. It was crazy. If you think regular police are dangerous, you have – they're kittens. They're absolute kitten cubs compared to military
police. I think I mentioned that one of the cops who had a gun to my head was a former military policeman.
They're unbelievable. They're loony. They're the most immature bunch of people you've ever met in your life. And, you know, I'm making a group accusation here, but that's what I believe. And there are people who want to go in there and be part of that action. And, you know, that's what they love. And some of these guys go off and they become mercs, you know. There's a lot of guys in Blackwater that are, you know, or formerly, well, Blackwater's gone now. It's some other company pulled it under. But, you know, they go off and become mercs. And now they're mercenaries.
Trained killers.
Well, they were trained by the military, and now they're out being mercs. And you can slap anything you want on it, but they make a lot of money. And, you know, they're not doing it for a country. They're hired by a private security company, and they do all kinds of stuff. And, and some of these guys, you know, they're just, it's bad news. So, you know, I love the people who went out, and I truly do remember them respectfully that went out, and they died. They gave their life, you know, to protect your liberty and your freedom. Unfortunately, you know, I can only name two wars where that was really, truly legitimate, where it, not that they were illegitimate, that they were misled into, you know, situations right. That were not real.
Well, none of them were in my lifetime, so I can't say that anybody has done anything, as far as I'm concerned, to protect my freedom. And even in those two wars, I mean, you're talking about the Revolutionary War is one of them, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that fine. What's the other one?
The War of 1812, like I said. That one was, we were being attacked. Maybe it wasn't as pure as a Revolutionary War, but, you know, England was coming after us. And so those are two wars that are so long ago. The Civil War, no way. The Civil War was a setup. You know, there's a whole, we can do a whole show on that one, maybe a whole month on that one. But so, I, you know, these people who really did give their lives to, you know, to make the place better for other people, that's just amazing, you know. And I remember those guys. I don't know their names, all, you know, a lot of them.
Well, but some of the Revolutionary, you know, War guys, I remember all their names.
They're, yeah, and they're, well, they're, I mean, beautiful.
Not like the regular, you know, you just know like the big names, like, you know, George Washington, of course, and I remember Nathan Hale, who was a spy or something, uh-huh, who got hanged, who was a, yeah, spy for the U.S., and, you know, Paul Revere, and, you know, those people.
When you read the history, you know, you can bring up the names, but, you know, but, and you know, so many of these people, these are some of the best people on the planet that really did this for genuine reasons. And they didn't want to do this, but they volunteered for it. Or if they got drafted, they really stepped it up, you know. But
when they celebrate Memorial Day, they're not celebrating for the most part. Most people are not thinking of, you know, guys from over 200 years ago. They're talking about more recent people. And, you know,
well, they wrap it all in a,
this, yeah, you know, they do, but they're, right, it's more about, you know, the people that have died recently and people that are still alive, that it's their loved ones. And I would say have a Memorial Day for everybody that died. What about all the people that were killed by police? What about people who did other things, heroic things to save people?
Ever do that, huh?
You know, why not have a Memorial Day to remember people that have died? Because the majority of these people that they're remembering, they're not heroes. A lot of them are murderers.
It breaks my heart to know and to find out after I was the way I was raised that they have bled out so many good people to perpetuate just absolute lies and it's disgusting, and I want people to be free, and dying doesn't make you free. So know what you're doing. You know, these poor young people that go in, they don't have a chance of understanding this. A lot of them find out very quickly what it's about, and, you know, use that awareness and recognize the truth. And you gotta love people, you know. Yeah, that's the only way we're gonna get out of this, because if we don't love each other, we're going to eat each other alive.
Well, I think one other way, which is probably going to sound really fucked up, is not being afraid to die. Too many people compromise because they're scared to die. And I'm not saying that you shouldn't be scared to die. I mean, personally, and maybe, you know, if it came down to it, I'd have a different opinion, but personally, I don't want to die. But on the other side, I'm not scared to.
Well, that's the real test, isn't it? And you can't be brave if you're not afraid. That's one phrase I really believe in. If you're not afraid, there's no bravery involved.
If I thought that my death would somehow bring freedom, true freedom, not this bullshit, then I'd let somebody kill me right now. But obviously, that's not gonna happen.
No, let's do it peacefully and just outsmart these guys, and tell everybody how great they are, and they don't deserve to die. There's not a reason they need to go off and die, because everybody's the same. There are very few bad people in this planet.
That's the other thing too, is it gets exaggerated, the amount of actual bad people, and that people realize the value of life too. They just think, you know, well, whatever, whether it be cops or whether it be military or whether it just be regular people, that they don't realize the value of life. And even if somebody might deserve it, if like somebody breaks into your house and the only thing you can do is shoot them, you know, to protect yourself, it's not something to be happy about. It's something you had to do. but it's not something to celebrate neither. So you don't ever want to celebrate death. I guess if there was somebody really, really sick that like went around raping and torturing girls, and you know, okay, there's a, maybe a couple
that's different.
There's a couple of exceptions there, but I mean, you know, 99.99999% of even the bad people, you know, isn't something to celebrate.
Yeah. Well, it's. I think we're running out of time here, Dave.
So I guess that's all for tonight. Thanks, as always, Pete, for joining us. Tomorrow, we will be talking all about transhumanism, and Ellen Ball will be joining us for that. Hopefully, she knows a lot more about it than me. That was that was one of the things that she wanted to talk about, although I've talked a little about it. I think it's come up before, and it's definitely an interesting topic. So I'm looking forward to talking about that. And Ellen, of course, is always great on the show. So we will see you tomorrow, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. Thanks everybody for tuning in. Check us out again, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com and on Spreaker.com.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take away, we force them. And at the end of the day, each and every man should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.